CoCoTALK would like to express its sincerest gratitude for the patrons who sponsor our show. Al Hartman, Alan Huffman, Blair Ledoux, Brendan Donaghy, Brian Joyce, Brian Weisler, Christina Armstrong, D. Bruce Moore, Davey Mitchell, Diego, Disney Saints fan, Eric Canales, Fedor Stamen, Grant Leedy, Jason Bucata, Jason Downs, Jenna Farron, Ken Reichard, Kyle Etter, Mal Funk, Paul Fiscarelli, Paul Shoemaker, Richard Lorbieski, Rob Inman, Stephen Wagner, Steve Bjork, Terry Steen, Terry Steggy, The Backyard Shed Gang, Tim Lindner, Tom C., and Tom S. Thank you so much, patrons. CoCoTALK is an unscripted live broadcast. Anything can and will happen. The views and opinions expressed by members of the panel and the live audience are their own and not necessarily those of the CoCoTALK show, its sponsors, affiliates, or subsidiaries. Open minds encouraged, sense of humor recommended. If any off-color comments were made, we're sorry.
Hi, this is Dale Lear, designer of TRS-80 Color Baseball, and you're listening to CoCoTALK.
This is CoCoTALK, the world's leading live talk show featuring the Tandy Color computer. It's time to drop your socks, grab your real-time clocks, and let's rock.
CoCoTALK is rocking the 8-bit world, keeping the Tandy flame alive. We may be mocked, but we'll never stop, because CoCoTALK is rocking the 8-bit world.
Good morning, afternoon, everybody, for another episode of CoCoTALK. We are excited to be here. Hope you're excited to be attending, and we've got a lot to talk about.
CoCoTALK is rocking the 8-bit world, keeping the Tandy flame alive. We may be mocked, but we'll never stop, because CoCoTALK is rocking the 8-bit world.
Hello, stars.
Hello.
Hello,
Gene.
Yes, that would be me.
Welcome to another CoCoTALK. And thank you, Tim Franklin had mentioned an audio issue and I fixed it on the fly. So I think we're good on any kind of echo and reverb. I'll keep an eye on that, guys. We are here for another CoCoTALK episode. I think you can see we've made a couple of changes to the look and feel of the show. This is
everything goes through NitrOS9.
That's right.
Our 2 megs are required to watch the show.
That's right. Well, we're going to do intros in a second. I have always said, I've said it many times, that our audience wants 3 things. They want Nick Marotta. And so we are going to give them what they want. Now, here's the only interesting thing. I'm going to play the introduction, Nick, and then go to your video. The only thing I'm concerned about now is that echo issue. But let's see. Hopefully Tim Franklin will keep us posted.
Can I talk over the video for the scores?
Yes.
My voice will go through?
You will be able to. I will. That's the goal anyway. So,
Tim said the echo's gone, by the way, just so it sounds like everything resolved itself.
Yeah, the only thing I'm going to be playing music.
Or now.
Yeah, the echo's gone right now. But hold on. Here we go.
High score challenge.
All right. Well, we have to log in first, of course, before we can. All right, so we had a really great week again with the game this week, as you know, Bouncing Boulders. We actually had 15 participants. I'll get to that. So Ken Reichardt, 90. R. Allen Murphy, 130. Grant Leahy, 571. Adam Tandy Guy, 662. Mark B, 698. Canadian Retro Thing, 748. Mr. Dave, 791. Me, 956. Tandy Clinic Computer 3, who's Rob Inman, 996. I missed that one, sorry. Mikey, 1054. David Ladd, 1137. Alpen Grice, 1492. ogStevieStrow, 1739. Catlord, 1821. And number one score, Buck Owens with 64-63.
Ridiculous.
That guy is a machine. So thank you, everyone, for participating this week. It was a great week with 15 people. That is one of our better weeks. I'm going to take the screen, if that's okay.
Sure.
That whole thing was awesome.
Which whole thing?
Green screen in the...
Oh, text. Good. Thank you.
It's all good. Great.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to take the screen.
Bring it back when you're finished.
Come on, man.
Hey, can you see that? So this was a submission by my name's blanking.
Buck Owens.
Buck Owens. This was from the Rainbow Magazine back in the day. As you see, somebody back then got 10,930 from Quebec. Quebec has a lot of Coco users.
Damn foreigners coming in here taking all our high score jobs.
Quite the gamers, too.
Yeah.
He also pointed out the review in Rainbow for Bouncing Boulders. It got positive reviews.
Nice.
For a fun, fast, colorful, challenging experience. It is highly recommended. So this was from the April 2017, April 87, I believe.
Did they spell Calore properly in this one?
No, it's an American magazine. So they spelled it the peasant way.
Okay.
So, yes. So.
Don't you mean ungrateful Americans?
Ungrateful Americans.
Traitors. Oh, what happened?
They left you out.
You'd minimize the video. It's down there kind of small.
You clicked the wrong button.
That never happens.
Never.
This is a live show, unscripted. Anything that can happen.
Level six. That's what I get for
fooling around. So this was another video by Buck Owens showing level six.
Yeah, his videos were very helpful this week. I was stuck on that level three or level four at first. And so he posted some stuff in the Discord channel saying, here's a way to safely get past the level. What is he doing?
I've never saw this level.
Now, it also looks like he's running this in the wrong colors, too, because aren't the colors supposed to be?
Yeah.
And that's okay.
That's all right.
The great thing about the color computers, we have many choices of colors to choose from. You can have black, white, red, or orange, or orange or blue, right? So,
and if you don't like orange and blue, you can swap them.
Yeah, orange or blue, or blue and orange. The choices are limited.
I think he was running this on a Coco 3.
Oh.
Without the F1. All right, so right now
he's pushing
dropping
all the boulders down to the bottom, right?
Yeah.
Getting them out of the way.
Don't they reach critical mass that way?
I don't know. He got whatever score God says he knows what he's doing. So
yeah.
I remember him mentioning that the layouts of some of the levels are pretty well identical to the the official game that was on other platforms. So
okay,
I'm sure he had some experience.
All right. So now, what is he going to do here? What are we doing? The suspense is killing me at this point.
So do you know where this game originated, Curtis? What platform it debuted on?
Was it the Atari or the...
It was on the Atari and Apple real early on. I'm not sure which one it came to. Oh, what the heck just happened there? Holy crud. What is going on there? Oh my goodness. They fall through a screen and turn into diamonds. I did not know that. Look at that.
It's an avalanche.
That is... my goodness. I did not know that it did that.
Those are the only way to get diamonds, apparently, because I don't see any diamonds anywhere else.
Yeah. Interesting.
I'll have to revisit that game.
And what level? That was level six. Now, level six was where I was getting stuck. Okay. That's pretty cool.
How far did he make it ultimately, his high score?
This is a 50-minute video, so obviously I'm not going to play. I don't know if this is his high score run.
4, what 000. The hell are those things there?
Level 17.
Oh, jeez.
Level 17.
Okay, level 17.
Okay, you're watching.
Now a rub it in video.
You're watching Buck Owens of Borg.
Right. Now, see, these colors are actually reversed. So what we were seeing is that orange thing was supposed to be blue. So that might have been a water block or something. I'm not exactly sure, to be honest with you.
I don't know what level this is. It doesn't have it on the screen.
I don't either.
It's a level we'll never get to.
Oh, yeah, that one. Lord have mercy.
So, yeah, I guess apparently this game gets quite challenging if you make it past level 4, which is the highest I
Well, you do have, if you play it and you select 99 lives, maybe you can get here.
I got 99 lives, and a glitch ain't one. Okay. Lava. Okay, so David says that should be lava. Okay. If it's lava, whatever the hell it is, but yeah. This is just insane. This is just crazy talk. Look what's going on here. Level 19.
Yeah, let's go to the end and see how far you got.
Oh, look at these. Now, is this like a bonus round? Because it looks like there's just diamonds at this point.
So, yeah, this would be his high score run because he's got 6,000.
Yeah.
I will stick a link to that in the
what an insane score that is.
Chat for those who are so inclined to want to watch it.
Look at you, Nick Marotta. You just saw like real timing there. Did you just hit clear in order to do that? Real timing, multitasking.
He's got a real time clock too.
See, that's where the code was more efficient.
I forgot that was going to go over. Hey, there's our game next week. That was an accident.
Oops. You didn't have to say anything there.
Oops. Fine oiled machine misses.
What's the game next week?
Are we done talking about this one? I guess the suspense has been killed for the game next week. Sorry about that, guys.
Was there any tips and tricks for you guys that actually played it?
Did we want to talk tips on bouncing boulders?
I got a tip for you. Buy low, sell high.
I think my tip is just hire Buck Owens to play games for you from now on.
Yeah, right.
That solves the problem.
It is great to have Buck back again. He took a couple weeks off. I was glad to see him back again. Mm. And it was good to see him number one. You know, he was really he's been really trying the last few weeks, and it's good to see him finally make it.
He'll go far.
What was the preferred controller of choice? I played on keyboard the whole time.
Digital gamepad, and then pulse it. Don't hold it down, pulse it. And I found that was a good way to do it. It would be relatively responsive that way.
I know. Okay. I heard some people recommending keyboard controls over the joystick completely. Did any of you, the rest of you, experience that?
I played on a real Coco. I was playing on Coco VGA. I'm not bragging, just saying. But I found that when I was using the arrow keys, I don't know if it was a latency issue or if it was just how the game mechanic works, but it seems like from the time I press and let go of a key, there was like a half a beat before it actually moved. So I had to kind of get used to the timing of the latency of the key springing to the actual game movement. And I found sometimes I would overshoot or undershoot or move when I didn't need to. So part of me getting into a groove was just anticipating the keyboard and game synchronicities that they would eventually come out to. But I enjoyed the keyboard once I got used to that. I tried it on a deluxe joystick and could not play as well. So keyboard worked for me for as far as I got anyways, which is level 6.
I am not fond of the deluxe joystick overall. Playing these few games these last few weeks, I have not found it to be as good as I remembered it.
I think it's what you get used to, though, because I didn't play much games with the modern joystick. So the deluxe for me actually works better in my case. I've tried the newer ones, you know, Xbox controllers, etc. And for me, they don't feel right for me, but that's what I'm used to. I think it's whatever you get used to.
Yeah, probably. Probably. So anybody else have any...
I think Buck uses an AI program instead of a stick myself. But, mm-hmm.
Oh, that's an allegation there, Curtis. You better be careful.
I suspect that Buck is an AI program.
Have we actually seen him? We haven't.
No. Alpen Grace says, I played on MAME with the Coco 3 and preferred keyboard 2. But he did not try the digital joystick, just analog before. Okay.
I found that delay you were talking about with the digital joystick too, but I never overshot with the digital, but I did find there was that delay before it would move.
Gotcha.
So, all right. Have we exhausted?
We are watching the show within the show at this point here. So,
why am I doing
Inception,
that?
Inception.
I keep forgetting I'm live. Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I can't just click around and okay. Sorry about that, guys.
Yeah. Are you still sharing?
No. Yeah. For now, because I'm going to reveal. Okay. There's going to be okay. Big shock.
You're going to re-reveal.
What is next week's game? Anybody want to put some money on this?
No idea.
Cavewalker. No, I'm just kidding.
It's not Tetris.
Oh, it wrong clip, wrong one. There it's we Joust. Go. Anybody name that game? No.
Can you name that game? Oh, I know what that is.
That's a prequel to Cavewalker, I think, isn't it?
That is Mario needed money and became a pole dancer. Is that what the name is?
Of course, it's Downland.
Mario in Vegas, I call it.
Look like Mario the pole dancer. So, okay.
So that is our game.
Downland.
There's a game for this week. And start anytime. And thanks again for all you guys who participated. I appreciate it a lot.
One tip for Downland, if you're playing on real hardware and you have the cartridge, if you have a Coco 3, you will need the 1.1 version of the cartridge for it to work. The 1.01 will crash and freeze. That was patched when they re-released the cartridge, so it's fixed. The 1.1 runs on both, but just in case you have the older one, you try playing on the Coco 3, will not work.
So that'll give you a low score.
Yeah, you'll be rivaling your Jason at that point.
I thought the icons changed when they did that, didn't they? Or the gems and stuff all got bigger on the second version of that.
I don't remember that, but I do know like the labeling changed, and yet that's one of the ways you can tell.
I think
the
label. I was very disappointed the graphics changed and they weren't as nice looking as the original cartridge when I bought a replacement. What is
the difference in the labeling? So, tell which one they have.
I think it's just a plain white label on the 1.1 version.
Yeah, it's got the smaller graphical image on it. It probably
says Tandy instead of Radio Shack 2 or TRS-80.
Yeah, the graphical image of Downland himself, the Downland picture is quite a bit smaller on the newer version, and on the old one, it fills the whole label just about.
I guess it's on the Coco SDC.
Yeah, and if you download the 1.1 version, it works everywhere. Michael Eichemeyer has actually given us permission to do it, and he had some interesting history about it, like the game was bigger originally and a whole bunch of other things. So,
okay, the one that's in the actual STC image that you is not good, so you'll have to find it, and we'll help you with that.
All right. Okay. Well, let's take a commercial break and we'll come back with intros and Game On and news and all sorts of things. So we'll be right back after these messages.
Hi, this is Eddie Zerbinski from beautiful Quebec City. Vous écoutez Coco Talk.
As you're enjoying Coco Talk, we also want to remind you about the Coco Discord server. This is a place where people come to connect, to ask questions, to provide answers, to share information, and to socialize. So when you're done, why don't you head on over to the Coco Discord server and we'll continue the conversation there. The easy to remember link is discord.cocotalk.live. See you on Discord! Coco123 is the Glenside Color Computer Club community newsletter that's been in publication since 1985. While the Rainbow magazine may be gone, it doesn't mean you still can't have a cool Coco periodical. Head on over to the Glenside Color Computer website at glensideccc.com and then click on the documents link to view all the past issues of the Coco123 newsletter. Not only can you read all of the past and present issues, we'd also love to hear some submissions from you. So if you'd like to send an article, a column, something to talk about, maybe even a program listing, send an email to glensideccc@gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you.
The Coco World Map is a cool community resource where you can view coconuts from around the world. Head on over to map.cocotalk.live and see where your fellow coconutians happen to be living on the planet Earth. If you would like to submit yourself to be on the Coco Map, send an email to cocotalk@cocotalk.live, and we look forward to seeing you on the Coco Map. Hey guys, it's Stevie Stroh, and if you've been watching Coco Talk for a while, hopefully you understand that everyone is welcome to join this show. You don't need an impressive resume to get on. You just need to enjoy the Coco and be willing to talk about it. There is no wrong way to Coco. There is no wrong way to be a fan of the Coco. There's no wrong way to be on Coco Talk. You just have to want to talk Coco. So if you would like to join us, then reach out to us on our Discord server, which is discord.cocotalk.live, or send an email to cocotalk@cocotalk.live, and let's get you on the show and let's talk about the Coco.
Hi, I'm Tim, and you're watching Coco Talk Live. And I'm playing Daggereth online like that idiot from the book.
Can you dial back on the condescension there as you respond there?
And we're back, everybody. Let's talk to our panel and then we'll see who's in the live chat. But first up at the top left, Mark Overholzer. How are you doing,
Mark? Hey, glad to be here. Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
Glad to have you here. Next, a man who knows a little something about DriveWire, Mike Furman. Welcome to the show.
Oh, just a little bit. How's everybody doing today? We're doing great here.
DriveWire.
RS-232.
RS-232.
SP-8266. Next contestant.
Ron Delvaux, who owns a garage that holds lots of things. Ron, how are you today?
I'm doing pretty good. Doing good.
Ron's here, man.
I'm here. I'm in the house.
And a man who is rivaling Ron Delvaux for the amount of stuff that he acquires and features, and you can kind of see it shifting in the background there. Terry Steggy is here.
Hello, everybody.
Terry, are you okay? Is that going to fall on you?
Yeah, we're having an earthquake here, I think. I don't know. It's rare in Wyoming, but we, I guess, have them.
Either that or I smoked a little marijuana this morning. I'm not sure.
I think we all might have.
Well, welcome. Also on the panel, my segues are just not on not on point today, but a guy who has MIDI and keyboards and analog and digital, and he's also learning ease of use, David O'Connor.
Hey, everybody. It's good to see this OS9 background today. Looks good.
Great. Well, thanks for being here. And I have a live demo later in the show on ease of use, so maybe it's something you might be interested in as a beginner to the platform.
Very cool.
But speaking of EOU, a man that needs no introduction, so we'll skip right over him. Nick no, he's L. Curtis Boyle.
Hello, everyone. Looking forward to seeing the demo. I don't even know what you're doing with it today, so.
It'll be a surprise. And you just heard from our extraordinary host who makes extraordinary videos featuring high scores and challenges to those scores. He's a man that must be named thrice because he's so nice. He's Nick Marotta.
Thank you very much for the great introduction. And unfortunately, I don't see Nick Marenti's here, but I want to draw attention to the fine trash can in the bottom left-hand corner there. It's
really he's in the bottom row.
Oh, is he there? You. Nick.
Yeah.
I'm admiring the trash can.
Everyone does.
Well, he's a bit squished.
Especially if Nick reminds them constantly.
And so, have you seen the trash
that's
can?
That's what the operating system's for, really. It all comes down to the trash can.
Speaking of DriveWire, this
this gentleman finally got DriveWire working for me by doing a tutorial video. You know him as the original gamer, Stevie Stroh.
Good afternoon, everybody. Yes, I have a simple two-step process where my NitrOS9 boots up and puts itself in the trash can and takes me straight to deck B. So,
I like it.
Just shows the efficiency of OS 9. I mean, NitrOS 9.
Well, deck B will get you access to that bare metal, and there's nobody who uses that bare metal access better than the
Deck B was just created for the DOS command to get you into NitrOS 9. That's all I got to say on that. So.
The madman, Simon Jonnasen, who knows how to exploit the properties of Deck B. How are you, Simon?
Good, thank you. So, long time. So, let's have a good show.
Great.
It's good day.
Hi, Simon.
Hello. It's good to have you here.
So I've probably got something to show you a bit later if you've got time, Frank.
Of course.
Very
cool. Absolutely. Next on our panel, we last saw him on the Oregon Trail hoping that he recovered from that dysentery. It's Paul Shoemaker.
Hi, guys. Nice to be back. Unfortunately, I don't have anything cool to show anybody today, but I'll hang around and have some fun with you guys today.
Excellent.
Sounds good. Ooh. Mobile, he's always on the move. His name's Coco Man, and he has products with switches and multiple switches and just what else?
Cable switches,
yeah,
cables, boxes.
Well, I am out and about obtaining essential services while on the way back from that, and I do. But what I was going to say. Anyway, but I do have something to show off. I don't think it's probably not that cool, but I'll have that to show off later. And I do have one question. Does a haircut count as an acquisition this week?
Yes. I acquired one, yes.
It depends which hair you got cut.
Ooh, look at that.
All right.
Hey, Jason, thank you for your switcheroo. Works great.
Yes.
Oh, thank you, Ron. Appreciate it. Thank you for your support.
Yeah.
Glad you like it.
Awesome.
Great. Yeah,
and good things about your stuff, Joey. You shipped Joey as well?
Oh, you shipped Joey as well. And these introductions are taking so long, I've crossed into three different states now during the introduction.
Patrick, I'm going to try to pronounce your last name here, Uland.
This is Uland.
Uland. This is Uland. Welcome.
And I have brought the rarest cocoa item that I can think of. It's Red Rubber Hammer.
Nice.
Elmar System 5. It's more dust than foam anymore, and I have no idea how it lived, but there it is.
Is that the CPU resocketing tool?
We whacked each other in the head at the 95 Cocoa Fest with them repeatedly. I think that was the game of the fest that year.
Yep.
Beating up the Red Rubber Hammers.
Is that for the MC10?
He says it so delicately.
Great. Well, thanks for being here, Patrick. Mark B is here, our sometimes co-host, sometimes streamer, always a good guy. And Mark, welcome to the show. Anything you've got in acquisitions or anything you want to tell us?
He's muted.
I feel like he's trying to tell us something.
Yeah, I feel
still
it.
Muted.
What's that, boy? Timmy's in the well?
Is Timmy in the well, Mark?
Well, Mark, you've never sounded better.
Yeah.
Need a sign language interpreter here.
Can we do charades?
All right.
For the heart of
first hearing. First word.
First word.
Sounds like. All right, we'll go on. Move on to Brian.
Show must go on.
Who hears just fine and makes terrific music. Brian, the music man, Shoebring. Are you out there, Brian? And how's your voice doing? I heard you had a cold.
No cold today. I'm just down in the Coco Cave and just kind of like having lots of fun making code work on the Coco.
Testing one, two. Testing one,
nice
two.
Nice bit of reverb. There he is.
Mark. All right.
Ooh, good code on the Coco.
Great to hear from you, Brian. And Mark, anything you've got to say for us, Mark B?
Oh, this week I'm trying to do some repairs on my backup Coco 3. It looks like I got a bad 8-volt regulator.
Oh.
Making it run real hot.
All right. Well,
so far so good. It's running now, just yank the regulator out.
Great. Well,
that extra part unregulated.
We'll come back to you and that regulator.
It's unregulated at this point right now.
That's right.
Yeah, just feed it 20 volts. Watch all the caps explode.
It's just an extra part. Didn't really need it.
Yeah, watch all the capacitors
it's running.
Explode.
Hey, it's running back there.
Well, calling in from the sub-etha, he's a man who knows the meaning of life, and it's 7 times 6. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Alan Huffman, and I think you're on mute, Alan.
It's great to be here again. I also wanted to mention that I too have a Delmar debugging tool.
Oh wow! Look at that.
So there.
It suddenly is not nearly as rare as it was a minute ago.
Still looks like it.
Practically, so. They practically were giving these away. Oh wait, they were.
Is it made out of foam or something? What is it?
The foam.
Oh rubber. Yeah. Okay.
Well, great. Well, thanks for being here, Alan, especially with our OS9 theme today. A man who knows a bit about code and makes Stevie's head explode, it's Mr. James Diffendaffer. How are you doing, sir?
Doing well. Great googly moogly. This is taking forever.
How is this any different from any other week?
Actually, we're ahead of schedule compared to most day times.
Right. Well, from down under, he's upside down, but he knows how to make a trash can or two. It's Nick Morentes.
Good day, everyone. Yep. Another day, another show. And can I just apologize in advance for the next person who's going to be announced, David Ladd. So for everyone who's going to listen to the next bit, we're sorry.
Yeah. Don't also turn down your mics because it gets rather loud.
Oh, Nick, you're not upside down here, Nick. You're up the right way.
Yeah, I know. You're the right way up, too. Everyone else is upside down. I don't know.
Yeah. Something going on there.
Is David right. Ladd there?
Why, hello, everyone. Are we ready for this show to get started? Well, I guess we already have. We've had the game on already. So are we ready to get the rest of the show going down the railroad tracks and hopefully it doesn't get derailed any further than it already has? Are we ready? Hey, let's get it going.
I'll have what he's having.
Check, please.
All right. Well, why don't we, Curtis or Nick, are you ready for the Game On News segment? We'll do some gaming news. Does that sound good?
Sure.
All right.
Cool. Well, that's Curtis. I just sit back and listen.
I've got it all queued up. So
Nick's my moral support.
That's right. You got this, Curtis.
We will play the intro. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Game On. Okay.
The challenge this week, unfortunately, as some of you know, my dad passed away this past weekend, so I've been busy in COVID times trying to help arrange a funeral and stuff, so that's been taking a lot of my time.
Well, sorry to hear that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Condolences.
Yeah, it wasn't unexpected. He's been kind of declining the last while, so they actually gave us special permission to actually go see him in, at the care home here the last few days he was alive, which was good because we hadn't seen him in a few months because of the lockdowns. As you all know, the health, the care homes have really been hard hit pretty well worldwide. So they were, ours locked down early. They haven't had a single case, which is nice. So we didn't have to worry about that. But yeah, it's been a bit of a time. Anyway, enough dwelling on that for now. Let's get on to some game stuff.
Okay.
Okay, let me share the
list. And I've got the first game up.
Okay, I got to wait for you to...
Oh, I'm already displaying it. Do you want to just... Do you want me to...
Oh, okay, yeah. I got a few of them queued up fast forward, but if you did that already, then yep. I'll just go on to the description. Did you get that third one from Arlen Lee, too?
Yep, I did. Okay. Can you see the screen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so Marlon Lee, who I mentioned last week, finally returned to the Coco community. He's been away from doing his videos for almost a year. He's been just knocking out the Coco ones here the last while. So he did a set of three Miss Pac-Man clones for the Coco 1 and 2. And he's not quite sure which one his favorite is, but the first one he did here is Spectral Associates Miss Gobbler, which features some of the different mazes. It has fruits, but they don't bounce around. It does have a little teleport trap thing that if you hold down the joystick button, you won't go through, but it actually will instantly teleport you. And this one is pretty close to their original Gobbler game, Ghost Gobbler. The only change was, you know, there's a little patch of red lipstick on the Pac-Man, no bow or anything. It does have the bouncing fruits. It does have multiple mazes. It's a pretty decent game. After I complete the three videos here for Marlon, we'll just kind of get a quick vote from the panel. Which one is your favorite version of Mrs. Pac-Man? So
this one looks pretty good.
Yep. It was the first one I ever had, so it's definitely, you know, probably first in my heart that way. But
I like what they did to achieve the four colored ghosts, right? So you have basically two solid and two hollow, but that gives you the four kind of personalities. And then at this point, then when they go like this, they just turn white when they're in kind of power pill mode. That's a cool.
And they do have the eyes tracking, like they shift their sight. Okay. You know, vision when they're changing direction, etc. So, but bouncing fruit, everything else, it's a pretty close clone. I mean, the mazes are quite different, but
yeah.
And then the second one he did is Miss Maze, which is from Tom Mix Software. And this one I think is probably closer to the arcade. The mazes are pretty close. It does sort of have intermissions. It's not the full animation intermissions, but it does play the music from each intermission.
It's the music of it, yeah.
Okay. Unfortunately, this one, the fruit don't bounce around, but it actually has, you know, some multi-voice music stuff that actually kind of makes up for it. It runs a bit slower, a little bit less smooth, because he's using some multi-voice even for the eating of the dots. So it basically slows the CPU down a little bit. So it's a slower paced version of the game.
But the bow on the head, though, looks a little bit more
arcadey.
Yeah.
And a little bit of eyeliner, too. Slanted eyes. So
that maze is exact.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's got all the mazes too. I've actually been
Miss Maze kind of looks like David Ladin drag as you really study this closely.
Yeah, it's got that same sheen on the head and everything. But yeah, I think out of all the three here, it's probably the closest visually and sound wise because it does use the multi voice music that's from the arcade. It does it for the intermissions. It does it for the main intro. So it's a pretty close version of the game. A little bit slower paced, though. I mean, their K game is definitely faster.
All four mazes?
Yeah.
Yes, it does. All right. And the last one, which he just put up this morning, actually is called Miss Pack. And this is actually by somebody who we've had on the show before, Mr. Terry Steen.
Killer of couches.
Oh.
So this was a TND software release. So this is that tape magazine where you could pay like $55 a year on cassette or $70 a year on disc, and you got a whole whack load of stuff. You got some games, you got some utilities, you got some, you know, applications and stuff every month. So this is one of those, quote, almost free games. And it's actually pretty good. It's got the floating fruit. It's got the different mazes.
Yeah, and the ghosts change colors.
Mazes are a bit different. You know, this one has two warp tunnels to go back and forth. So
yeah, that's neat. I think the original arcade did as well.
Yes, on the first
level. Yeah, one of the later levels or was the first one? I can't remember.
The first level did, yeah.
Okay. I've played it also.
This is good.
All right. We should actually get him in to talk because we always talk about some of his other games here, but this is one we haven't actually discussed too much with him. So,
all right.
Nice. Good to see Marlon Lee back on YouTube again.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I've actually gave him a bit of an invite to get him on the show, but he hasn't responded yet. So okay. I'll keep bugging him.
The next one I have is Roger Taylor.
Yes, Roger Taylor, of course, is the guy who did Matchbox Coco and Mr. Coco, etc. And he's been testing various programs to make sure they work. And he actually stumbled on something in Xenix. Now, it's mentioned in the documentation for Crystal City, for example, if you hit the 1-4 key, you can actually skip some of the levels and you'll start on a different level. And that works on Xenix, too. Now, the levels are not officially numbered, but basically you can jump, I think it's some like four screens worth. So if you want to get to the levels where you start seeing the big monsters that are coming across, or when the screens start to shake all over the place every time you get hit, if you strike the 1 to 4 keys, you can actually jump, you know, up to 15, 16 levels ahead and actually play the game. So some of you who are not that skilled at the game but want to see some of the stuff we keep talking about playing Xenix, like some of the boss monsters, some of the special effects that come on the later levels, this is your way to do it. And I had realized this a long time ago, but totally forgot about the fact that Xenix supported that same system that Crystal City did. So that was kind of cool. And Roger's not normally known for, you know, playing games all that much. So it was cool that he found it.
I'm just curious why he posted that in a NitrOS9 group when it's technically it's an RS-DOS game. But still good to know.
I think he just did that by accident. He might have even been meant it for the Matchbox Coco group or something and just happened to be there when he posted it.
Yeah,
I've been known to do that.
Yeah. All right.
Okay. Nice.
Next up, Jerry Young, and we've had him in the chat here before.
Pitfall Jerry.
Yep, Pitfall Jerry. He did a live stream last Saturday, and unfortunately I didn't catch it at the live time he was doing it, demonstrating a version of Dragon Fear 2 that he himself has modified and improved for the MC10.
Oh, nice.
And he's actually got the code listing on the lower right you can see there, and he actually explains the changes he did, what they accomplished. So it's kind of both a game tutorial and a game demonstration, as well as a coding and patching a game demonstration.
Neat.
And it's like an hour long. So, but it was pretty cool. And I think this is the first time I've seen him do one of this type where he actually does actual coding. Normally he's been demoing, you know, the 1,000 new Jim Gary games from last week type thing. But in this case here, he actually goes through some of the coding practices on the MC10 and some of the things he did. So that's a pretty interesting tutorial, and it's not, you know, high level difficulty stuff, but for somebody who wants to learn to program the MC10, this might be a good video to start. We can kind of watch them live do it with a completed program.
Neat. Right. Dragon Fear 2, Fear Harder.
Fear Harder.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. More fear.
More fear. To double the fear.
And this here is the download. He's got the source code for it here if you want to fiddle with it. And he's got some of the other projects that he's actually been involved with. He's modified a few other games previously too that you can see down near the bottom, like Sub Hunt, etc. So if you want to download some of his stuff, Jim Geary's actually got a competitor for downloadable MC10 games now. So,
Did he get permission to do this?
I think actually Jim was giving him some tips and stuff too, to be honest.
Okay. All right.
The competition heats up.
That's it.
Jim's not really competitive that way. He'll help anybody. I mean, he's written OS9 stuff. He's written Coco stuff. He's written MC10 stuff. He's a machine like Buck Owens is playing games.
Right. Neat.
Next up, I believe Alan Huffman can pipe in on this because I think he's the one who discovered it. Jim Allard, who's quite famous. You know, he's a very high up person at Microsoft. He was part of the people that founded the Xbox part of Microsoft. He's been in various other companies and high things. He's actually joined the Intellivision group that's actually going to be releasing the brand new Intellivision Amico game console.
Mm-hmm.
And he had his bio here from the announcement, and he actually mentioned that he did a version of Lemonade Stand for the Coco. That was his first computer, which I did not realize. We've had a couple of famous people that's been discovered to have started with the Coco. I think the other one was the guy who founded Netscape recently, Mark Anderson, because he actually had a letter published in Rainbow. Now, have you been able to find anything else out, Alan, about... We're trying to find the version of Lemonade Stand he's talking about, and I haven't found it yet.
Yeah, I have not, but I did find a reference in an interview from 2006 when he was with Microsoft, and he did specifically mention he wrote this game when he was 12 that was Lemonade Stand, and it had the quote, I should have waited 10 years and called it Sim Lemonade. So it doesn't...
Sim Lemonade. That's funny.
Yeah. It doesn't mention color computer, but it says he was 12 when he did it, so it might not have been a commercial published program.
Okay, because I did find some other Lemonade Stand clones, and I played the original Lemonade Stand on Integer Basic on the Apple II back in like 79. So.
Yep, it's one of the old standards.
Yeah, I played it on the Commodore CBM in high school.
Yeah, and Jim Gary ported one to the MC10 sometime in recent years. He's got a video on YouTube, but I don't know what his source was.
Yeah, and there was a clone of it published in Rainbow. I'm trying to remember what year it was, 84 or something. I found one, but it wasn't
August
by Jim.
1983.
83, okay. The game's
issue. Guy from Iowa. It's called Iowa Lemonade.
I owe a lot of money, but anyway. next up, speaking of Jim Gary. Jim Gary released this port of the demo adventure game that George Murr published in the July 1982 Rainbow. And this was cool because the following month, August 82, was the very first Rainbow I ever bought. And he actually had a program there called AdvMaker, which is the skeleton of what this game uses. And it's basically a framework in BASIC to set up your own adventure game with the arrays, you know, predefined and stuff. And then you just fill in room details and object details and if-thens if you want to do certain things. And I actually ended up using this program that you're kind of seeing demoed here as a basis for my Ring Quest game. I just added graphics to it. So I had an extra array that had, you know, draw statements to draw monsters and rooms and stuff like that, that I entered in the Rainbow contest and surprisingly actually placed in. So this one kind of hit home with me because this is the program that I based that on. And that was the very first published program I ever had. So it's a pretty cool. And if you guys want to learn how to write adventure games, August 1982 Rainbow, the article by George Murr that this is based on, is a very good article on explaining how to do it and a very nice basic program framework to get started. Very easy to use. And next up, there's three videos here from Michael Pitsley demonstrating some more of these multimedia, you know, early cassette-based multimedia with the motor on, audio on commands, doing Disney stuff. So he's got Mickey's Alpine Adventure, and he did two videos. He did Short Vowels and Long Vowels, which is two parts of the same game, two different sub-games, I guess you'd call it. So he kind of goes through it. Demoing, and then he also has the Telling Time with Donald. And, of course, if you have the audio turned on, you can actually hear, like, you know, the actual Disney characters speak, and there's narrators and all kinds of stuff. There's little bits of animation, and they're all educational. So these all came out around the 83, 84 time frame, and are pretty rare gems, I guess. I mean, they were, I remember seeing the advertising catalog, but, you know, educational software when you're a kid, who wants to play that? So it's kind of fascinating to see these now, because I didn't realize at the time they were multimedia, and we've been actually seeing Michael review and play through these the last few weeks on the show, and it's been quite a education. Should to learn about any, all the multimedia games we audio? Had back then. Yeah, if you want to throw it on for a little bit.
Can you hear? Nope. Can't hear anything.
Well, it depends on what part of the game. Sometimes it doesn't actually. Or you can switch to one of the other ones. I think the audio is right. A simple sign, monsieur. It plainly
says stop. But it doesn't.
Do you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It says stop.
Is this like in French, like steep?
You see, it's spelled S-T-I-P.
That is correct, mademoiselle. S-T-I-P. Stop.
But sir, well, stop is spelled S-T-O-P. The sign is incorrect.
Impossible.
Typical French.
Oh, look.
Impossible.
Impossible.
There's a old Rob stirring the controversy.
Yes, and how you say stop. Yes, it is a stop sign. Oui.
And here's another one.
The address to send your angry feedback will be up at the end of the show.
Spelling with long vowels.
Spelling with long vowels? Is that what that said?
Yep.
Vowels, yes.
Ah.
Not long vowels.
Not vowels, no.
The large intestine.
Don't worry, boys.
Don't worry, boys. You need a translator for Donald.
Boys, is a package item on the list. They have placed a check mark beside it on the page. But three things had not been checked off.
I love Donald's voice.
Absolutely.
Now, did any of us here, because some of us are the right age that these would have came out when we were in school, though mind you, I think some of us were probably a little bit old for this type of thing at the time, but did anybody here actually play these back in the day?
It looks familiar to me.
I was too old.
I actually sold these.
Did you? Who was that, Brian Shubring?
Yeah, when I used to work at Radio Shack.
Were they popular, or like did just schools buy them, or did parents buy them, or what?
It was more for the kids and that, but you know, parents and whatnot. But it didn't really catch on a whole lot in this area. In other areas, it was a little bit more popular, like especially down in Texas area.
Well, the quality is really good. The production value, the artwork, the recordings. You know. So, and the cost to get into this, you know, cassette player was pretty cheap. What is like $60 for a cassette player? These were probably maybe $15 to $30 to buy. So this would have been an affordable way to get some good stuff on your Coco. And I think that was one of their selling points. They wanted to make it seem like an educational tool. And I believe mission accomplished here with these products. I think some of us might have been a little bit past that age group when we started. We were probably, you know, I was like 12 to 14 when I Coco'd.
Yes,
but had I had this when I was a kid, I would have enjoyed it.
Yeah.
What year did this come out, supposedly?
83 and 84. So the cuckoo bird told Morty and Bertie about her home. Depending which one of the series you're talking bird. About.
Yeah, it'd have been about I'm 18.
I'm assuming all the audio on these is like, you know, motor on audio.
Yes, one yes. It's yeah, all cassette relay based. Yeah.
How does it go? Say your cassette. Oh, I suppose the cassette player wouldn't load the program if the speed was wrong. But if the speed's slightly wrong, is it possible for them to get out of sync and like stop at slightly the wrong spot? Did anyone ever experience that, or were they pretty good?
It could, and I did have some third party cassette recorders that were a little bit off. But I think they left enough gaps between, you know, an image showing and then when. And it would actually speak, and then before the next one showed.
Do you know, did it actually load the image data off of tape too, or was all the graphics preloaded and it just paused?
As far as I know, it preloaded a program that drew the graphics.
Okay. So it wasn't like it had to load the artwork.
Yeah. When I remember playing with these, probably at a Radio Shack, because there was a black hole one and it played the music from the movie and had dialogue. And I think all it was doing is listening for silence. So it would open the cassette, it had a general time, and then it would listen for silence. It's kind of the same trick we used to use with carts at the radio station, but we'd put an inaudible tone on there. So they could have done something as simple as that. It would play the audio and wait for there to be a silent gap, and then it would know that it was done. You know, when it have some general time.
So okay. I didn't realize you could actually access the like the audio is obviously going from the cassette into the TV speaker through the computer.
Yeah, I guess you have to sample the DAC, right?
They've got audio on, but you're still bringing in data.
Yeah,
because we used to digitize stuff off the cassette deck too. I remember utilities to do that.
Looks like Terry's holding something up. It's kind of hard to see, but we're not.
Yeah, I've got this set of those. I have not seen this one before. It's called Math Probe.
That's
Space Probe Map. Sorry.
Having a blast with the new Math Probe.
I think didn't we cover that one last week? I'm trying to remember.
Yeah, that's the one that's kind of like the black hole one. Yeah,
I like the black hole one. Sorry.
And I'm gonna avoid the obvious reference of probe and black hole. I'm not gonna go there. Wait,
yeah, we're not
dead.
Soft from work here, so
too late.
And was it mentioned that other computers didn't have this ability at the time?
I think we mentioned that either last week or previous week.
Are you asking did Tandy market that, Ron? Is that what you're asking?
No.
Oh, because honestly, that would have been a missed opportunity. That would have been a great selling feature saying, you know, other computers cannot do this. So I don't know if Tandy marketed it that way.
Not that I recall.
The things that we can see that no one else can right now, luckily.
So in BASIC, can you use like a peek command to actually look at the DAC and see what's coming in through the audio? Can you?
Alan, do you know? That. Alan Huffman?
A peak command?
Yeah, it's the audio is coming through the computer onto the TV, so I thought maybe there's a peak command that can look at the DAC to see what's happening so that you can
Look for you used audio on, and whatever played on the tape would play under the screen. I used to write a program that would sit in a loop and do audio on, audio off, and go to, and it would give you kind of a Dalek sound, and I would use that for doing simple voice processing. And there was a peak that just checked the DAC to see if there was anything there. And it would either be jittering or it would be either ones or zero. It's the same thing you would peak when you were recording audio through the cassette board.
Yep, okay.
Interesting.
Yeah, I never got that far. I did demos.
Did most digitizers, anything that did a digitizing, what did it use? Did it use the cassette port or did it use a joystick port or what?
You could do a one-bit sample through the cassette port, and that was published in Rainbow. And then you could do a six-bit sample using the joystick port. I think Jeremy Spiller had an article in Rainbow called Analog to Digital and Back Again that I think used just the cassette port to do digitizing. And I remember typing that in and then modifying
it. I used that, and I remember I remember digitizing a Van Halen track.
Yeah. And there was another one in Hot Cocoa that did the 6-bit DAC to the joystick port that did a recording too. And it would actually slow it on the graphics screen. So it'd record 6K of data through the analog port, and then you could play it back.
Cool.
It's kind of hard to hear you guys over the cassette there. That's okay. Cool. Yeah, this is neat though. This is definitely a unique application of the Coco's ability to mix audio and bring in an extra source and output it through the RF out. You know, we had the cartridge line to bring in audio, and we had the cassette of different ways to bring in audio. And I think these were unique features that not all other systems had.
Yeah. If you guys remember Rockfest from the Rainbow, it was a list of, you know, some of the big bands of the time in the 80s, and it had their logos. There was two of them, I think, in two different issues. But I actually took one of those. I could put Van Halen here, and I'd had an audio cassette with one song from each band. And I'd actually run the program. It would, you know, hit Van Halen Jump or something like that, play that through, switch to 38 Special, then bring, you know, Teacher or something like that. And I actually made a whole cassette that actually would put the logo of the band playing the song by the band, and you could let it run for a full half an hour.
That's cool.
Yeah.
If we're talking about audio here,
you know anything about a Coco Audio, Simon, by any chance?
No, nothing at all, mate. Nothing at all. Can I demo something for you guys here? Can I share my screen?
Sure.
You'll need to stop.
Is this the demo that you threw up on Facebook?
Yeah, but I'm going to show you what's behind it.
Okay.
Because I'm going to be covering that in the regular news too, if you want to wait. But if you have to go quickly, no, we can do it now.
We can take a break from Disney here for a second.
This was perfect timing because we are on audio and we're on samples and stuff like that. So I thought it was perfect timing for this.
Yeah,
so,
grab the screen, Simon.
Okay, let me grab a screen. Sorry if my icons are all over the place and it looks messy and whatever, but it's just me. So what I'm going to show you first is the video I posted on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
So there we go. Share. Mm-hmm. Right.
Should be able to.
And make sure to click sound too.
Screen, share. Yeah, my computer's obviously gone AWOL, huh? Right, okay.
There we go. We see a Windows wallpaper.
Go.
Yep. Yeah, my wallpaper, yeah.
It's lovely.
It's very unique.
Okay. I need to move you guys about. So here's the actual sound stuff. Listen to the dish load on this, if you can hear it.
Yeah, we hear it. No, man, that sounds good.
Yeah.
Now, your message said that took 48K?
45K.
Yeah, I'm assuming you're using samples of different chunks. You're putting them together in sequence to create a longer track.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming you're using 1024 byte sectors to load in that fast, because the distro did the same thing.
When everybody talks.
I'm just using normal 256 byte sectors.
Oh, are you? Okay.
Yes, I'm just using a special loader for it.
Are you doing like read track then or something? Or?
Yes. No, I'm actually not doing a read track. I'm just doing a special interleave on a normal disk. So let me share. What I want to share here is to do this. I came up with a VB script to do this, to take a sample and to section it or to convert it to 4-bit differentials. And then I gave it to Paul Fiscarelli, and Paul Fiscarelli actually made a VB.net utility to do it 10 times faster. So I'll show you that utility fast. So if we just grab this utility, and then I'll grab part of this sample. I'll just go like scared. You seeing this?
Yep.
Okay. So I've got to move your screen about so I can.
Look at this. Speak. That's very cool. You can tweak it for Coco 1 or 2.
Don't be scared. see you soon. I can just drag stuff into this.
Neo likes it.
Sorry about that.
We should sample Neo.
I can just drag stuff into this and go.
That is really cool.
Yeah.
So you're like sequencing everything.
This is part of a tool chain we're making for the spuds.
And this is a Paul Fiscarelli tool.
Yes, backed by, originally using my code, but turned into something else. But yes, it's a Paul Fiscarelli tool.
He's an animal.
Yeah, well, you used my code.
You were saying what these are, 11.025 kilohertz or something?
This is 11 kilohertz.
Yeah, nice.
If I take the original, the way I sectioned it, this is Audacity. I'm just going to do a...
Neo likes it a lot.
For each track.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That is very cool.
Question is, how do I get rid of my... I've got to stop sharing. No, actually, I won't stop sharing. I'll show you the code behind it.
All right.
I'll show you...
I will mention, like, using those little snippets and kind of linking them together to make the full song is kind of how the mod player that Sockmaster did, too. Except it's, of course, doing up to four at once, but it does a little same thing with little samples. Mind you, it allows pitch shifting and reverb and other things you can apply to them, but it works on the same principle of taking these little clips and then just reusing them over and over to keep the memory size down.
Exactly. But this is the actual code behind what you're hearing.
Wow.
Sorry, Spuds, that was it.
That's neat. That's cool.
Very cool.
It is. When you think about some of these tools you guys have, how much time that saves. Like, you can just grab these samples in here and then generate it as Coco code. And I know people are working on tools to do this compiled sprites for you and generate the ASM code for automatically. So having these extra augmented things that you can run outside of the Coco to rapidly create things for the Coco, it's got to make life so much easier, right?
You saw the way that I could just drag a sample into a
program,
and just, bang, you got FCB statements. That's cool.
Yeah,
I could just press test, and it would fire up VCC and test it for you on VCC.
It's insane.
That's cool. And the other part of this tool chain, and I think Mr. Frescarelli would probably hop in at some point. The other part of this tool chain we're making for you is a sprite compiler, and it is wicked.
Wicked.
It's wicked.
Awesome.
That's cool, Simon. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah, very cool. Brilliant.
It's good to see you again, mate, too. It's been a while.
Yes, well,
absolutely.
Real life gets in the way sometimes.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. Well, do we have more Disney now? I'm really jonesing for more Goofy and Donald.
No, we're done with Disney.
Oh, yeah. Shucks.
And now we're playing that game like the guy.
So this one here is somebody who's new to me anyways on YouTube, has just started playing a series of Daggerath and apparently is planning on winning the game. They're kind of doing little bits of commentary as they go. And their very first run for an hour here, he got to level 3 and then died. But he did a pretty good run here for a straight through, and he's, like I said, playing a continuing with and actually trying to win the game past level 5. So for Daggerath fans out there, might be
he's
a challenge to watch.
Daggerath like that idiot from the book.
can you tone it down a bit, Steve? Pretty sophomoric of you, you know.
Yeah.
Still one of the greatest games of all time.
Absolutely. Not one of the greatest game of all time.
And that's one that cross-platform, like people that never liked the Coco, that's one they admit was way ahead of its time.
Yeah.
And the last one here, Cuthbert Dragon, who's been, of course, uploading a ton of Dragon games. And a lot of them are Coco ports, so you'll see a bunch of PMode 3 versions of games we're used to seeing in artifacting mode. But they have a couple here that are a little bit rarer for us to see. The first one of those would be called Mind Out, which I think is on the left on the bottom there. Yeah.
Mind Out.
That's a base game. It's actually got, I like this. It has, you know, adjust your color to make sure they're correct on your TV. Kind of like the program that Jason's yeah. doing.
CRT there too.
Yeah, this is the Cuthbert Dragon channel does all the recordings off of real hardware on a real CRT with a camera propped in front of it. So it's complete authentic with retro experience.
Complete with background reflections on the CRT, right?
Yeah.
He's got the camera synced well to the CRT. There's
no yeah, you don't see a lot of the wavy line stuff on there.
Hmm.
This is Bill. Oh, look, Bill's wagging his tail. That was cool. I'm so easily amused, I guess, right? So. Simple things for simple minds. Safe.
Good band. Great band.
Don't you forget about me now, David.
No. I'm still alive and kicking.
So it's kind of loosely based on Minesweeper. You'll see in the upper left, it'll say safe, which means your surrounding area is safe. And occasionally it'll say okay. One mine or two mines, and you have to try to guess which way to go.
Oh, look at that. Yeah, that's neat. You did it. Oh, so you have to just navigate the minefield.
One side to the other.
Okay. That's neat.
Speed bonus.
It kind of has like a dig dug snake feel to it as well, right? You're carving your wait a second. Now you can see them.
This is the replay to show where you went and where all the mines were.
Oh, that's where the mines were. Now, I like how it scrolls down like that. That's a cool effect.
Yep.
Mine laying. It says laying.
And mystery bonus. So you get some mystery bonus. You don't know what those are, but you know where they are. It's actually a pretty good take on the mine rescue style games because it's actually got some innovative gameplay to it.
Absolutely.
Look, looks too one said three mines, so which way do you go?
Looks too Kobayashi Maru to me. It's like, I wouldn't want to play this.
That's neat.
Some sound too. All right.
Neat. And he escaped. Escape with your life.
I think that's it.
Just press clear.
Yeah. All right. And then the next one on his page that I thought we'd take a look at is The Dark Pit.
All right.
Much just like hit back and then, yeah.
Yes.
The Dark Pit.
Yes. Yeah. Now we have seen this game. Oh, it's up above the Mind Out. We have seen this game before on, I think it was High Retro Game Lord or something a year or two ago. But he didn't really know how to play it. This guy knows what he's doing. Wait, so he actually goes through screens and screens of levels.
That's a split screen. There was graphics and text on there.
Yeah. That's just a V-Sync timing thing.
Wow. Now, this is cool looking.
You want to go back and see that?
I want to see that. Yeah. Look at that. You see that, folks? Graphics and text on the same screen. It's like peanut butter and jelly.
That might be just drawn. I'm not sure what color if that's red or dark blue or is that black?
It's kind of hard to see, but it looks...
He could have done the VDD. No, actually, I don't think he could have done the VDD trick because he would have had no green border around it.
Yeah, the text should have had a black graphics, border. Yeah.
So maybe that's P-Mode 4, then he's mixing P-Mode 4 and 3, possibly, because that looks kind of high-resy.
That he possibly could be doing.
Okay.
Switching to the two-color mode to make it
impressive.
And the sound in this game isn't too bad, but the fact that he actually manages to get through all the levels and he gets the keys and he's opening the right doors and he's... You know, picking up all the treasures. He actually did way better than High Retro Game Mode. He actually goes through like dozens of screens in this playthrough.
Yeah, I like the brick and mortar with the red and yellow here actually work out well.
Hmm. And this is realistic.
Hey, look out for those freaking pissed off faces. I don't know.
Those are some mean dice.
All around me, I see pissed off faces.
And then you can actually get a weapon, which I don't believe High Retro Game Lord ever got to work. So you can actually shoot things, but you have to pick up the ammo and stuff first.
Oh, you got little pack dudes, pack ghosts. You got prizes to pick up. This is neat. Oh, look at them. Yeah.
And there's quite a few screens. So I don't know how about the total is, but I've seen at least, you know, a dozen or two dozen in this playthrough alone. So
yeah. It's very kind of linear pattern based. It reminds me a lot of the AGD type stuff where the things just move on that track.
Yeah.
But that can present its own challenges.
And there's little shapes in the background drawn from the maze elements itself. Like they'll draw a big happy face.
Was that just like a European thing? Because it seems like a lot of the Spectrum games were like this. A lot of the BBC games where it's just you have this path trajectory that the things continuously kind of bounce on. But they're all timed out to where it's still work to navigate that.
Yeah, there seemed to be an extraordinary amount of the maze slash arcade games where you have to like solve the maze type thing. So, yeah, I have noticed that too. And I'm like, it's not a bad thing, it's based on it, but
it's just an observation. I'm not, trashing that idea.
I mean, I think every country or every area has its own favorite. Like North America, we tend to do the arcade style. This was popular in Britain and Europe, and Japan had, of course, their whole set of cutesy things they usually did.
I'm guessing that's either RF or composite. That's really clean signal. Or is it RGB? That looks like.
This is off a TV, so this is not RGB.
So you can
see. It's just a regular TV, so it must be composite.
You can see like the line.
It's PAL, mind you, if that helps.
Yeah, neat game. All right, cool. Short attention span. Next.
Okay. All right. So that was it. That's the end of game on. So.
Okay. All right. Cool.
And now these messages.
Hello, I'm David Ladd. Thank you for watching Coco Talk, the world's leading live Coco Talk show.
Good night. This is Nick Marionettes. Crikey. After you buy Gunstar.
Stop right there.
Okay, fine. After you bought Gunstar, go ahead and buy your copy of the Coco Fest edition of
Nightmare Highway.
Nightmare Highway.
It's a quarter of the quality at half the cost.
ESP 8266-01 RS232 TTL Wi-Fi network 4-pin DIN FitBanger DB9 PC IP drive wire.
Not yet.
This portion of Coco Talk brought to you by Placeblex dietary supplement.
DB, I don't know.
Placeblex, thought to help you with your floppy life.
Don't yell at me.
In a world where hard drives rule and floppies are superfluous, one man, one legend, one old fart dared to learn the floppy and took the brunt of jokes.
All right, I'll look for that one.
Then all hard drives and SSDs died, but the floppy survived, and the only man who knew floppies became a legend once more. Floppy Life, the David Ladd story. This summer, straight to YouTube.
8-slot MPI, floppy drive, Coco SDC, Sound Speech Pack, Orchestra 90, RS232 Pack, Modem Pack, Super IDE. You start adding all those together, if you want them all usable at the same time, well, guess what? You just went over the 4-slot MPI.
David Ladd.
Oh, I'm much happier breaking stuff.
From around the world, what you need to know. Get caught up on News with El Curtis Boyle.
And now a Muppet News Flash.
Okay.
Of course, the first story is Simon's players on Facebook, because he put a couple demos up of that playing, so I don't know if we need to replay those or not.
All right, well, let's start with this screen. So we did just talk about Simon.
Yeah, but we couldn't hear him because everybody talked over it.
Okay, so everybody be quiet.
Ignorant.
Be quiet, everybody.
All right. So do we want to play that then so we can
Yes, please. Please.
Okay. I think I can
and
do that.
And mute everybody so everybody can hear it.
I think we played it twice.
That's cool.
All right.
Holy Clip, crap, my subwoofer's rocking.
Yeah, clip so nice, you must play it twice.
yeah, the low end on that was really, really good.
Yeah, even in my headphones.
I had to turn my speaker down. My neighbors would get mad. Wow.
Yeah. Good job, Simon.
I'm using my mastering headphones here. They're like $1,000 pair of biodynamic headphones, and they go really low, and that went really low.
Is that $1,000 Australian or American?
Yes, $1,000 Australian.
That's like $2, basically.
Like, yeah, $2 American.
Yeah. cheaper than a $5 ukulele.
Yeah.
All right, here's another one.
Shh, everybody be quiet.
I give up. Who's back?
I think Shady's back.
Shady's back. Okay. Can I tell somebody? Can I tell anybody about that?
Backstreet's back.
All right.
Sheldon MacDonald had a farm.
You know, these look like disc brake pads.
They kind of do, Ron.
I had to say it.
3D print your own brake pad.
Uh-huh. Last for one stop at one intersection, and then you'll go through the next one. You need another car.
I think it'll only last for half a stop.
What kind of plastic do you use for that?
You know what they said when they use those brake pads? Stop right there.
Stop right there.
Run into the caboose.
Oh.
All right, Curtis.
You guys are very juvenile today. Curtis is muted. We need to unmute him. If you guys could tone down the juvenility, our audience would appreciate that.
No, leave Curtis muted.
Am I unmuted now?
You are.
Yeah, no.
Okay. No.
So anyway, Sheldon here has put up what he's considering his final designs for the Coco Gamepad cases, and you know, a couple of different sizes. I think Stevie, you've got a couple of the original prototypes. That you
yes,
on the show
one
before,
like the ones so. On the left, ish. Yeah.
Yeah. Is there a favorite out of these four designs for people here? Like, do you like the jagged edges, or do you prefer the smooth?
I like the actual smoothie one.
Yeah, so do I.
That looks kind of more like Sega Genesis style shape. You know.
I love my Black Beauty.
The smooth one looks a bit classier, I reckon.
Yeah, I think so too. Now, did anybody Nintendo. Notice he 3D print the smooth, or does he have to like sand it to get it that smooth? Or
I don't know.
I'm not experienced with 3D printing, so I don't know if you can do curves like that normally.
Yeah,
with
David. David Ladd yeah, has one.
Yeah, you could. You could print curves like that, but how smooth it is another thing.
If it's a filament printer, usually you have to sand them. But if it's resin printer, they're usually pretty well cured when it's ready to go, and it's ready to go.
I'm looking at the edges of one of my Coco SDCs here, and that's I don't know whether it's I think it's printed that way, but the rounded edges are really smooth, nice and
you know. Nice.
Yeah.
Right, there's just the striations from the layers that you can see, but as far as each individual layer being nice and round and precise, you can do that.
Okay, cool.
There you go. I like
so anyway, it. He's pretty close to getting ready to release them. So
is he going to offer four different models, or is he going to settle in on one?
I don't know. He doesn't really say that here. He said he'll reveal the final ones. I soldered it all together. This last version is a lot smoother to hold. So
okay. They're neat, and I've used them. I like them. I got cool. A couple. Yeah.
Okay, next up. Richard Harding. Now, last week we showed this Diagnostic Dragon board that Phil Harvey-Smith had that you plug into this card slot and you can use it to test the dragon. Mm-hmm. But we didn't really know what it covered. And it actually covers quite a bit. So there's a screenshot here from Richard Harding who's actually been using it to test and fix his dragon. If you scroll down, there should be...
I don't see anything.
Just hit clear, Rob.
Yeah, just hit clear.
Yeah.
Okay, let me see if I got it on mine.
Yeah, I was noticing that some of the permalinks did not take me to articles. They took me to, you're not even a member of the group. That might be why you're not seeing the permalink there.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's not a Coco 3.
Error. Wow.
Let's stop the sharing for a second here. I can show it on mine because I've got it linked on mine. And I think it's because you're not a member of the group.
Yeah.
All right.
It has
its privileges.
That's it. Dragon Group has really high standards, Rob. Really? So that's why you're not in there. So.
There you go. Go ahead.
Yeah, it is a private group, so must be a member.
Can you see that?
Yes.
Hang on.
I see it.
It's sort of.
Yep. Fixed. Go ahead.
Oh, there we go.
Okay. Yes. So this is showing some of the tests it's actually done, and you can see it's actually checking for like spurious non-maskable interrupts and spurious FIRQs and stuff like that. So it's actually checking to see if chips are firing when they're not supposed to be and stuff. So this is a very sophisticated testing program and hardware that it comes with. And you know, RAM testing is kind of a bit more standard, and then it probes for that Dragon Plus version of the Dragon as well. But it tests like the IRQ signals and cartridge signals and all kinds of stuff. So, if we ever get a diagnostic tool like this for the Coco 1, 2, and 3, I think it would help a lot of the people that you know buy one off eBay to figure out exactly what's wrong with it, and you know, possibly be able to fix it. So, I don't know if there's any plans for him to do that to make a Coco specific version, or maybe some of this stuff works on the Coco because they're so similar.
Let me ask a quick dumb question here.
Yep.
And I don't know if we have all the right hardware people on here, but so unfortunately, in order to diagnose bad RAM, you kind of can't if the RAM is bad and doesn't boot, right? Because you know we have some of these Cocos that boot up with weird text on the screen because we have a bad RAM chip and stuff. So is it possible? I'm just thinking out loud here. Could you have almost like a Coco on a cartridge that had its own CPU and RAM and had its own output capabilities where it could boot up, scan the Coco motherboard and tell you what's wrong when the Coco can't, right? Because isn't one of the problems of this diagnostic that if the Coco can't boot, it really can't tell you what's wrong with the Coco, right?
Well, if you remember from last week when we showed the actual board that plugs in, it's actually got its own LCD display on it.
Okay, so it is doing that.
So I think it can do some of that. I don't know to what extent. I don't know enough details on the hardware board itself. And okay. My understanding is it actually can do some tests that normally would be impossible with a straight ROM card.
Okay, fair enough. It would be neat that it had its own kind of external cognizance where it would know things that the Coco couldn't know if the Coco was not.
I do know it has its own LCD display built onto it, which you showed last week. And then that way, if your screen's not working because the VDG is dead or the RAM where the VDG is trying to write to is dead, it would still be able to write to this diagnostic.
Gotcha. Okay, so that part, that does address that. Yeah. Concern that. Okay.
And I'll just stop sharing now and let. Okay. Now the next story I'll just read out because unfortunately this post has been removed. This isn't a permissions thing because it's dead for me now too. But Curtis F. Kaler had posted on the MC10 Facebook page a program utility, and he had versions available for download at the time for both the MC10 and the Coco that would list all the files on cassette and kind of give you a cassette directory. Oh, so you're dealing with cassette images or real cassettes there, and you had a bunch of programs on one tape image. You could actually go through and get a listing of them all. And it would tell you if this one's basic, this one's assembly, et cetera. So if you're trying to find stuff on a hoard of backup tapes from 30 years ago, you had a way to do it pretty nicely. So unfortunately, that post was removed. I don't know why.
Okay.
Next up, TJBChris, who's actually in our Discord now, has this video showing OS9 Level 2 booting from OS9 from ROM, and this is from the Cloud9 ROM kit that Boise had made way back in 2003 or 4 or something, and kind of based on his original Toyota project where he actually had a Coco 2 with a special boot ROM in his Toyota truck and would actually monitor parts of the engine and what it's doing through the serial port. So, but he goes through the whole thing of burning this on the EEPROM and also demonstrating that when you turn on the Coco with no cartridge attached at all, it's just the straight Coco with its modified ROM. It just boots straight up into OS9 level 2 with a very limited couple of commands, and it boots up an 8K RAM disk so it can run a few brief things. And he shows here from ordering it, like he ordered it years and years ago from Cloud9. He finally got it installed, and there's versions for the Coco 1 and 2 and for the Coco 3, so you can use it on any of those machines. I don't think this is quite as useful as it was back then, because with the SDC, you can boot up pretty quickly and you can change that whenever you want. You don't have to burn a new ROM. But back at the time, it was actually quite cool. And if you were a heavy OS9 guy, this was a way to not have to worry about this silly disk basic crap that Stevie uses all the time and jump straight into a real operating system. So it was kind of cool.
Is this news or an editorial?
Both.
All right, just checking.
It's an opinion piece. There you go.
This has been a Coco Talk editorial.
Yeah. The right opinion, of course, but anyway, it's a pretty fascinating video. So
And on a bit of a side note, he released a second video too. He actually upgraded his Model 16 to running an unreleased version of Xenix that Tandy had commissioned to get programmed, and it was just about done. And then Tandy kind of dropped supporting the Model 16, so it never got officially released. And the person that originally wrote it passed away, and then the code was found in his old disks from somebody that bought out the stock of all the stuff he had. And it's now available on one of the Tier City websites now. So if anybody who have Model 16s, you want to get the version of Xenix that never got released, the latest version, it's actually available. So he does a lot of really cool videos. So I'm glad he joined us in Discord. Okay, next up, Darren Ottery, another Aussie. And I believe, David, he got this cocoa from you, didn't he?
Yeah, that's right.
So he kind of sanded it down, painted it in a kind of unique color, not the original, silver, but not totally black.
And a slate.
He's got a Coco 3 keyboard in it right now. He does want to replace it with a more, Coco 1 level keyboard to make it, a bit more closer to the original. But I thought his paint job actually turned out quite nice.
Yeah.
And David, do you have any history behind this computer that you wanted to kind of mention, like how he got it from you, et cetera?
Yeah, it actually, I got that from America. I can't remember where I got it from now. Did I get it from one of our crew anyway? It came over. It had a cassette unit bolted to the top of it originally. So it had holes drilled in it, and it was a little bit scratched up and everything. So Darren actually had to sand it right back and then fill in all the holes with bog and then go back and paint it all. So. But it's an NTS because it came from America. It had the melted keyboard in it originally, which it came with. And it came from a school over there. So it had the name of the school and everything engraved into the top of the case as well. So it would have been quite a task to sand all that back. But the history behind that was I was after another Coco 3 for my Coco 3 into Model 4 case project. And Darren was after a Coco 1 because he didn't have one. And I had that, and he had the Coco 3. His Coco 3 wasn't working. It just came up with a green screen, and I knew that before we got it. But we agreed to do the exchange. That Coco 1 wasn't working originally either. It developed a fault where it wouldn't boot properly, and it was just the 6847. So I replaced that with another 6847 and got it up and running. So we did an exchange there, and both ended up with something that we wanted. And didn't have to exchange any money except for the postage. So,
cool. Yeah, that's what we like to hear. Like a lot of people have been complaining about, eBay people that are trying to sell Coco 3s for hundreds of dollars and, basically just jacking prices up. But actually seeing a couple Coco people just exchange stuff when they need it type thing and not have to go through all this rigmarole is a pleasant thing to hear about rather than, this Coco 3 selling for $1,000 on eBay type thing.
Yeah, absolutely. And the Coco 3 that I got from Darren in exchange for that, the fault turned out to be faulty RAM. It had the 128K stock RAM in it, so I pulled that out, and I had a Tandy 512K bank here that I'd pulled out of my other Coco 3 that I'd upgraded with a 2 meg boomerang. So I stuck that 512K of RAM into the one I got off Darren, and up it fired. Worked great.
Cool.
We have a new term here from David Lord. This has not been retro brighted. It's been retro dulled.
Yeah, retro blacked just sounds too bad. So. And the next up, Jason Downs posted this just to make us all jealous. He's actually got one of the first prototypes of the Gimme X that is given a limited release for software developers here from Ed. So he actually shows it here, and then he has actually got it installed. And
this is a good photo down here.
Yeah, that's Patrick. Pretty well the rest of us at this all point. Now, I've been watching on Discord. He's been doing some tests there, and there is a couple of glitches. Now, some of them were kind of expected. Like Guardian is a game that uniquely uses a weirdly weird mode between the SAM and the VDG that expands the screen. Like all of the semi-graphics modes are 32 bytes wide normally, no matter which one you pick. Guardian actually uses a weird wacky one that changes it to, I think it's 42 bytes wide, and it does the center of that 42. And Guardian used that so it didn't have to do clipping calculations to scroll aliens off the screen. It would just basically displays the middle 32 and the outside bytes. You can just run the alien off and then just shut it off. You don't have to sit there and mask it and figure out, I only need to display the right side, not the left side, and all this other crap. So it is exhibiting some issues. And he also mentioned that Protectors 2, which uses the little animations of the people you're rescuing by using different slices of the lines in your text characters. Apparently the Gimme X
defaults to the T1 VDG style character set. So those were all shifted to make room for Descenders. So Protectors 2, the people aren't showing up right. Now, I know in the Coco VGA, you can just load in a new font with the original VDG set, and then that would work fine. Mm-hmm. I don't know if the GIMMIX has that capability or if there's a way to switch the alternate set. So I don't know. We'll have to talk to Ed to see what the if there's anything to be done about that or not.
Sure would be cool if Ed came on.
Yeah, sure, absolutely.
Would. Absolutely.
Yeah, we've all invited him, but he occasionally shows up in the chat. That's the best we can get, but I don't see him in there right now.
That is neat. He's on Discord, so you can reach him on Discord.
Yeah. No, I just mean for as a public service so that people can just ask questions all at once because some people aren't on Discord. And
Yeah. All
right. Regarding the GIMMIX, too, I was on the beta program. I actually still technically am on the beta program for it and was really looking forward to receiving my GIMMIX. But both my Coco 3s are PAL Coco 3s, and apparently the GIMMIX won't physically fit into a PAL Coco 3. So I think might have to organize something with Ed and see if I can maybe ship him over a PAL motherboard or something, maybe do an exchange for an NTSC one, and then he can have a PAL board there that he can work on to come up with a modification, and maybe I can... an NTSC one here.
Yeah, I can't remember what the inside of a Coco 3 PAL looks like, but how much different is it? Like, is it just because it's going to hit another board or another chip? Like, maybe you just need an extender to lift it up higher. Maybe you can't put the case on it or something. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think it's that kind of thing.
Keyboard connect to the starters.
Yeah. There's other things like the there's components in different spots on them, like the C86 or whatever it is. You've got a snip for the RAM. Isn't near the RAM on a PAL Coco 3. It's actually near the gimmick. So there's little things like that, components in different spots, and no doubt there's a few components that are clashing. So there's something maybe I can work out with Ed, and we can nut something out to get a PAL version of it up and running.
Okay. Jason's actually in the chat right now. He says, "Hey, now I was just posting as a public service, not to make people jelly." Well, it didn't work. You made all of us jelly. So. Anyway, thanks for testing out some of the stuff here. We're kind of getting some idea of some things that Ed has to either address or at least see if there's a way to fix it. So that's good to know. I'm on the beta program too, as is Bill. In fact, we're planning on doing some support. We're probably going to release a NitrOS9 5.1 way before our beta 6 is out, which will have some bug fixes we found in the current version, but also to put some basic support in for the GIMMIX, like using the extra clock speed, maybe adding a couple of the modes in for the CoVDG so people can write games using the 256 color mode or something. But fairly limited at the beginning here because there's a lot of stuff we have to rewrite. Anyway, next up, Jerry Stratton, and we've had this on before. We created the Super Basic, which is basically a modern looking language that you write in, like using modern style. And then it'll convert it into disk basic code. And we kind of demonstrated that before. It's actually written in Python, I believe. But he's actually made a manual for it, and he's got a kind of an updated article with some sample code and some of the new instructions and stuff that he's got in there. So you can kind of see what the original code looks like versus the new code. And I think Alan Huffman had tried this in the past and was pretty impressed with it. But he's actually got a manual that he's got up that he just posted here in the last couple of days. And it's actually available as a physical book off Amazon if you want to get a printed copy of it as well. Which is on the second link I gave for this story.
That's cool.
I friended him and invited him to the show. So we'll see if he comes maybe next week. Who knows?
Thanks, Ron. He has popped in the chat once or twice. I don't know if he has in a while, but when we first talked about it the first couple times. And Alan, I think you said you had some pretty good experience with using this back when you first tried it.
Well, it was a real easy way to write something as if you were using a modern language. And if you don't really care about what code it generates behind the scenes, it's a heck of a lot more maintainable.
Yeah, so there's a basic code that got generated from that. Okay.
This is that an RAMable DOS, right?
No, it actually runs on the PC side. Then you run this code through it and generates the code for a Coco. That little clock face he showed up there. Sorry, go ahead.
It would be fun to combine this with some kind of optimizer that could redo your code and move things around and pack it and squish it before it goes to the machine. So you could write something that was easy, but that could still end up being pretty fast.
Yeah.
So what are we looking at here is something that uses a modern language and then recompiles it into Coco Basic. Is that what we're getting at, or have I missed something here?
Interprets it into, basically translates it.
Basically, that's what it does, yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
It lets you write it in a more modern like programming environment, and then it translates that into normal extended basic commands with line numbers and two letter variables and stuff. Yep. So yeah.
But will it work underneath OS 9 though?
But I think it's written in Python, so if somebody ports Python to OS 9, sure.
Well, you're seeing it through NitrOS9 right now.
That's right. Yeah,
there you go.
In a window.
Yeah, using one of those fancier Gimme X modes, apparently.
That's right.
With a really nice trash can.
Anyway, Rob, the next link should be a link to his book on Amazon. You can just show the cover there quickly, just so that.
There it is.
Super basic.
Which Ron actually found. So, mm-hmm. And that little clock he's got there, the P-Mode 4 clock.
Yeah.
That's actually the sample program from his page that he shows that's as a neat. Demo that generates that. So.
Cool.
And I think it's $5 for the physical book on Amazon, and the ebook version is free. So.
Wow, that's very affordable.
Can't beat that.
With rising entertainment costs.
That's right.
Next up, is Terry still on the call? Because I might have let him introduce this.
Oh, this is we're enabling this person's at this point. This person has what I would call a quote problem. Unquote problem. Yes. So
I have multiple problems. We're giving that now.
And yes, that means we're jelly, just like with Jason. So.
Well, I'm actually remodeling a section of my house, and I decided to organize all my TRS-80 stuff. Needed to segregate it from the Apple, Commodore, and all that stuff. So I decided, well, I've got it looking pretty decent. I'll go ahead and take a few pictures and put that on my Tandy Shack. I hope to have it actually displayable and everything working and turned on when I get done with my remodel. So
everything working and turned on at the same time?
Hopefully.
So wait now.
Oh my gosh.
The whole neighborhood's lights are going to flicker. Yeah.
So when are you getting the electrical upgrade?
Yeah.
Well, actually, I am putting in a bigger circuit breaker, and I'm putting all the wiring in myself. I've upgraded to, or I'm working on upgrading. God dang it, wiring's expensive.
Yeah, I think a nuclear power plant might be enough energy for this.
There you go. Yeah, these don't tend to like solar, I've found.
Anyway, so as far as segregating your other equipment, like your Commodores and stuff, there's this brilliant trash can that Nick designed that I think
would be perfect. Yeah, exactly. So you're practicing proper retro distancing. You're keeping all the crap away from the Coco so it doesn't get infected, right? So
I'm really going to do it because I'm throwing it all on eBay.
So do you have another wall filled with the other computer stuff that we're not
seeing? Actually, it's I've got probably 6 more shelves like that with all the other stuff, but they just aren't as pretty as anything Tandy or TRS-80. So they did not get the love that this stuff does.
Yeah. I did notice you cheated a little bit. You have some dragons in there too.
Yes, well, that's Tandy related.
Yeah, and I have a brand new one in the box coming. So I'm, dang it, I can't. I need to stop in the middle of this remodel.
Yes, you need help.
I do.
Terry, first step is admitting that you have a problem.
Yeah, and the next is to give us all the excess stuff.
Okay.
Intervention of Gary's place.
Enable the rest of us, please.
It needs a flux capacitor to run it. 1.21 gigawatts.
Absolutely.
Next up is Terry Trapp, our second Terry on the show. And this is an update to, we actually talked with him, I think, was it last week or the week before?
We did a Sunday night thing and he joined us.
So he's trying to figure out a way to replace a salt chip, which was a custom Tandy chip. In fact, there's a discussion in the comments here about who designed the original salt chip. And he's been trying, that's one of the chips that's fairly hard to replace. And he's actually been working on, you know, doing a clone so that you can replace it if it does die in your Coco One. So he's actually, looks like he said basically here, it looks like it's basically working now. I'm not sure if he's planning on making a much smaller version of the board to sell or make it, you know, a reprogrammable chip or something to duplicate it at some point. But he actually has the hardware working now. So, unlike last time, he didn't blow anything up. So that's good.
How often are these a problem that they go?
I don't know. Does anybody else know that? I'm not really a hardware guy. My one Coco One here doesn't have that.
How resilient is the salt chip? Hey, we have a question for Terry Steggy from Kevin. He wants to know if you're married. I'm assuming that he's interested, but he wants to make sure, do you have, is there a woman in the house that's tolerating this
problem of yours. So.
I've been married twice, but I do have a girlfriend that's living with me now. So
okay.
She does tolerate it, but luckily she's pretty short, so she fit under these tunnels.
She doesn't listen to this show, does she?
Yeah, right. So
not this one. I'll make sure of that.
Pete Willard says they have been known to fail, these salt chips. So
yeah. Let's talk about marriage. It was only the Coco 2s that had the salt chip, wasn't it?
Was it the one or the two? I can't even remember anymore, to be honest.
I think there's
Coco 1 doesn't.
The 3 has it too.
Does it?
Yeah, because okay. Because I sent some to Bill Noble for one of Curtis's.
So I wonder what Ed Snyder's doing in his custom Coco 2. Because Ed Snyder has a Coco 2 clone.
Yeah, the chips themselves only really require pretty standard voltages. So I would imagine he wouldn't need to do a special.
I think he would do something more modern.
Yeah.
Require an ancient chip like that almost impossible to get.
You can supply the necessary supply rails to.
So it's basically like a voltage. Through. It's a voltage regulator in a
pretty
sense.
Much. Yeah.
They used that in a pass transistor for the original power supply. So back in the days, we abandoned that and just went with 5 and 12 volts and abandoned the original power completely, and we didn't need the salt chip then. But that's requiring a PC style power supply to power everything, which you don't want if you're just wanting to fix a Coco.
Yeah, and that's back when everybody was doing repacks and stuff in like, you know, tower cases and things. So
gotcha. Okay.
Okay. And we have
the last one here. This is Boise's episode 2 of his Color Coco Collector series on YouTube. And this episode is covering one of his Korean Coco 2s. Which is kind of a middle-aged one because it's old enough to have the Radio Shack label, but it's modern enough to have the full travel keyboard. And also has the normal VDD chip, not the upgraded T1 lowercase chip we were just discussing. So
pretty
kind of goes through it. He does a little bit of his cleaning of it type thing, takes it apart, kind of show you some things.
I'm going to go through and wipe it really good. Surprisingly, it's clean, even though it's been sitting on the shelf, but still going to wipe it down. A little bit of dust is showing up on the baby wipes. If you'll recall in episode 1, I talked about how I use baby wipes to clean color computers. Really good way of doing it. The moisture picks up the dust and the dirt and the grime really, really well.
All right.
I've turned over the Coco.
Also has that soft baby bottoms feel on the keystrokes.
Sure does.
I actually use baby wipes to clean stuff in my workshop as well.
And a very pleasant scent afterwards.
That's right. So zooming in on the RAM chips here, you're showing off the ROM.
Yeah, he kind of goes through and explains the chips, like, you know, this is the color basic
ROM. And by the way, Boise's back on Discord. And we had a nice chat with him the other night. He jumped on our voice chat and just kind of got an impromptu history of DriveWire because Mikey was on. We were talking about DriveWire and how I'm getting into DriveWire now. So it was really cool to hear the kind of the history of DriveWire from Boise's perspective, what he wrote it for himself to serve a need that he had. So it's kind of cool to get that backstory. So it's
and he still supports the Mac version of DriveWire that's written in Java too, doesn't he?
Well, he has the
Mac
I guess he's
version a 64... is Mac version is either I don't remember if it's written in
not Java, something else,
Objective-C
like
or
Swift
if it's,
or something like
Swift.
That. I think it's Swift.
Objective-C.
And it's supporting the 64-bit Mac OS app model now too, so which is important for you updaters.
What's amazing is none of his screws go on the floor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. And there's none left over. I typically always have
Ron's
none left over.
Hardware sessions go.
And speaking of DriveWire, he actually demonstrates running it on this particular. Well, he does it with everyone just to make sure it's working properly.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a nice implementation he's got there, DriveWire. Mikey.
Yes.
I need to get some GUI stuff going
pictures
there.
Pictures like this.
I think your reaction pretty well answered that question.
somebody know JavaScript and CSS better. Uh-huh. We could get together and do great things for DriveWire. I really think it should be a web implementation.
Neat. That is cool looking.
And that is the end of the news.
And that's the rest of the story.
So why don't Six we o'clock do... news.
Let's take a moment to welcome the new members to the Color Computer World Map. This week, we'd like to say hello to Dan Loyal in Seattle, Washington, and Grant Blodow from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Welcome to the Coco community. If you'd like to be added to the Coco map, visit us at map.cocotalk.live. Welcome back, everybody, to everyone's favorite segment, Who's New to Discord? This week, we'd like to send a welcome to Terry Trapp, Glenn, Jerome, OS9er, Boise Pete, Color Computer Store, Princess Lizzie, Polaria Poyon, Carl Loken, Travis Pope, Firehawk, who's a MAME contributor, Jim Rye, JB318, Jason, Shark on Wheels, Bruce G, friend of David Ladd, Pat from TTR, who hosts a TRS-80 Discord server, Lance C, Jim Rayburn, Norinia, David, Grant B, Horrid Cola, Cole, Bill Pierce, Roger V, Bob Ebert, and Adam C. Also a special thanks to David Ladd, Rob Inman, and Alpen Grace for boosting our Discord server. You can join us on Discord by going to discord.cocotalk.live. All right, we are live. All right, guys, we're back. We just hit crash. So we are back. We're back on the air. Sorry, a little technical difficulty.
What happened to NitrOS9?
Brought to you by NitrOS9, remember.
Brought to you by NitrOS9.
That's what happens when you try to run NitrOS9 in a virtual Windows machine. You should be running the real thing where this does not happen.
Yeah, that's right. So this portion of Coco Talk is brought to you by Deck B. Always there for you. All right, so
that's why we have backups.
Deck B, of course, since Stevie's running Windows, I fully expect this to happen again.
That's all right. We still have a backup.
All right, so we're back. We're on the air. Yeah. All right, so good night, everybody. Thank you. What's the last thing we were doing? So Rob was showing some of the welcome to the Coco map.
And I think we got through that. I think we got through that.
Yeah, that's when it crashed.
I cut off in the middle. Well, you might want to replay that segment.
We'll run that next week. Yeah. It wasn't that good, trust me. Anyways, so we finished news. Is it time for project updates and acquisitions? Is that a good enough thing to do?
I think it is.
All right.
We did that already.
Well, wait a second. Don't we have a special presentation from Jason, the Coco Man Riker?
Don't forget Coco Thoughts as well.
Oh, yes, we have. Is Coco Thoughts really a special presentation?
I don't have Coco Thoughts queued up because I wasn't streaming. So
never mind.
We'll get it. We'll get it going, though.
We'll get there.
So do we want to run... do we want to run, Jason, your deal?
Yeah, I can screen share. I've got that all set to go.
Okay, I am not sharing anything, so you have the power to share.
I have the power. Let's see how this goes. Okay. We got a test pattern there.
We have a test pattern.
All right. Let's get this show on the road. That's not part of the presentation, but. What was the background on this? We had some comments about the in jokes here on the show, and that was a bit of a barrier to entry to get some of the jokes on the show. So just for the fun of it, I went ahead and set up a little program here, and we'll go ahead and load that. I think we'll load that.
Here we go.
Okay, there it is. It's loaded now. Let's go ahead and run it. A quiz program called Barrier to Entry, and this went along with suggestions from the Discord group in the community, and a little bit of coding help on a few things. And thank you, Paul Fiscarelli, for I hit a little brick wall there on the engine, but I have 23 questions in it right now, so it could expand. I will have this available on my blog at cocoman.org. sometime in the near future. And if Jim Gary, if you're out there, I'm already working on the MC10 version. So you can dedicate your time to other things. Because believe me, there's things well worth more working on in this silly little program. But I go through a few of the questions if you want there, guys. So let me go ahead and press any key and we'll begin.
Are there any caches and prizes available?
Just bragging rights.
Okay.
Here we have question one. David Ladd has an affinity for A, fine wines, B, arts and crafts, C, French cooking, or D, floppy drives.
I don't know.
Down diet, Dr. Pepper.
It's a tough one.
C.
Where's floppy drives?
Dr. Pepper.
Where's Pepper? Where's E? All right. We all know it's
floppy drives. RS-232.
We know it's floppy drives, so we'll go ahead and see. Oh,
only those of us know.
Kevin says E, all of the above.
Dr. Pepper only if it's a 2000
So, yes, okay. It's diet Dr. Pepper. Don't forget that. And it's like a 60-40 ratio. We've been through this. Okay, so let's go on to question two. Which Terry hit a couch on the way to Coco Fest? Was it A, Terry Stege, B, Terry Steen, C, Terry Bradshaw, or D, Terry Dactyl?
Terry Dactyl.
Terry
Dactyl is Steve.
Terry Dactyl.
Did you have a cameo in the Gangnam Wars thing?
Right, it may be. Oh, let's see.
I'm going to say Terry compels Terry Bradshaw.
Bradshaw? Oh, let's see. Wrong.
Do we get a chance to do it over? Do we get a do-over?
No, no do-over. Go on to the next question.
Oh, you messed us up, Stevie.
Oh, there's a...
Now we're never going to win.
Here we go.
Not going to get 100% this time.
Question number three. A beverage containing a mix of Diet Dr. Pepper and water is known as A, Arnold Palmer, B, bad idea. C, David Ladd, or D, Coco Man.
I'll take
like B and C. I don't know.
C.
I'll take bad idea for 100.
Yes. My Jeffrey, Let me see.
I'll take things I'd never do sober for 100, please, Alex.
What is this? Is not Jeopardy. All right. Question four. Who is known for their unintentional live stream? Is it A, Steve Stobridge, B, David Ladd, C, Grant Leedy, or D, Nick Marionettes?
Oh. I thought it was Grant Leakey.
I thought it was Grant Leakey.
Greg Leakey.
That never happens, so it's got to be
Greg Leakey.
Greg Leakey.
It's Greg Leakey. We are correct. You are correct. You are correct. Yes, you are correct.
All right.
Let's move on. This is a great game.
It's riveting, yes. Question five. Whose name is so nice we must say it thrice?
Beetlejuice.
Is it A, David Ladd, B, Nick Marotta, C, Rick Adams, or D, Beetlejuice?
Mikey.
Drive wire.
Do you know the star Beetlejuice is spelled differently?
That is, that's got to be Nick. I'll take Nick Marotta to solve the puzzle, please.
Oh, let's see. Do you want to buy a consonant?
Yes, I would like to buy. I'd like to buy in continents. Yes.
There we go. Of course, it's B. All right.
Nick Marotta.
Question six. Rick Adams thinks you are not kind enough, B, sufficiently kind, C, too kind, D, kind of a jerk.
I think
yes,
you
thank
are
you, thank you. Too you're,
kind.
Thank you,
you're too
you're
kind.
Too kind.
Yes. I'll take D for 50 cents.
Please, this is an exhibition, not a competition, as always. Please, no wagering.
Actually, I kind of want to hear him say the fourth one there.
Mm-hmm. Actually, I think that was Rick's idea, too. That choice D was, he liked that one, because originally it was going to be in need of a haircut.
Mm-hmm.
Question number seven. Who is Mr. TDP? Is that A, Mark Overhoser, B, Ron Delvaux, C, Terry Stege, or D, Tony David Peterson?
$1,000 for Ron Delvaux.
I'm going to go with Jim J. Bullock for the block, please.
No.
This is not Hollywood Squares. I'm sorry.
That's Terry Steggy. We are
every Terry sure is. Yeah, see, yeah, Terry Steggy. Yeah.
All right.
And here's question 8. Who is Nick Morenti's quote unquote neighbor? Is it A?
Oh, I don't know.
A, David O'Connor. B, Darren Audrey. C, Brian Joyce. Or D, all of the above.
That's all of the
panel. I'm not
all
the above,
Alex.
Oh.
Is the answer upside down?
Oh, of course it is. Yeah. All of the above. Who is known for not getting past level 1? Is it A, Grant Leedy? B, Nick Morentes? C, Steve Strobridge? Or D, Losey McLose-Lose?
I have to say, the answer to this particular one, I think, has changed over the last year, though. I think Nick Morentes would probably be the one. Martin Steve actually does these days.
Unless it's Gunstar.
Well, for the sake of the sake show of lore and yes. everything, of course, it's C.
C.
Yes. Yeah.
C.
Yeah.
You are correct. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Question 10. Richard of Boisintech needs to work on his A, poker skills. B, solder skills. C, people skills. Or D, plumbing skills.
It was definitely not B.
Yeah, if it's B, I wouldn't want to order from
There's
him.
No one right. the above.
Well,
people skills. We all know Richard.
Yeah, right. Yeah, for the sake of this discussion, it's people skills. And that was suggested by Richard. So, question number 11. Who sends screwdrivers with everything he sends you? Is it A, Mark Overhoser?
A.
B, Tony DiStefano? C, David Ladd? Or Phil Phillips?
Pick Rob Robertson.
Well, in this case,
I know what the answer is because I wrote the program, but I also have about a half a pound of screwdrivers here to prove that it was Mark Overhoser.
Mark D. Overhoser for the win.
Of course.
Yes, and
Mark, I got one from Coco Fest.
Only one? I'm surprised.
I
love it, Phil.
You weren't being stingy.
It's the same size.
Yes, unfortunately, they're all identical.
Except
for the one that Eric got, which was Phillips. Somehow I got in there.
One got mixed in there. They're actually pretty handy.
No, they are.
Here's to be fair, here's question 12. Who is known for saying "stop right there"?
Michael Furman.
Stop right there.
Stop right there.
That is John.
Is it A, Steve Sturbridge? B, Michael Furman. C, Jason Reichert, or D, John Haltman.
Haltman.
Haltman, very nice.
I like these D's. They're all good.
Yeah, I've heard Nick Morentes do a good job saying "stop right there."
That's a great impression of a bad impression. Yes. Icon. Well, of course, we all know it's Jason, yours truly,
Jason the Coco Man.
Yes. So that's
it's not me. Darn.
Definitely not. Question 13. Who keeps his extra cocos in his garage?
Joe Hoarder.
Is it A, A, Steve Strobridge, B, Terry Steen, C, Ron Delvell, or D, Joe Hoarder?
Terry Trapp.
D for the win.
I think I see the answer to that one.
Right, of course.
C and D are the same.
It is, you know.
It's also clear.
There is a reoccurring segment on the program called Ron's Garage. Of course, it's Ron Delvo. Yeah, and it is a dry heat, so maybe that's good to store those cocos.
I'll take 100 from each of you.
Question 14. Who soldered their hair?
You, Mickey Mouse.
Is it A, David Ladd?
No, but what's that smell?
But who soldered their hair? Is it A, David Ladd, B, Grant Leedy, C, L, Curtis Boy, or D, Steve Strobridge?
All of the above.
Curtis. Yeah, surprise you.
Steve doesn't Curtis have any Boyle. Hair.
Yeah.
That's how I learned to use a curling iron.
Of course, it's C, L, Curtis Boy. I thought the two, you know, especially answer A was kind of funny since he doesn't have any hair.
Apparently, he did that a lot in his youth, and now he can't anymore.
Maybe that's why he doesn't have. Because we know it's Al Curtis Boyle, so we'll move on.
There's no timer on this quiz game. So.
Yeah, so there's no timer. It's in basic. It's basic and a bunch of data.
Who or what killed the deluxe color computer?
John Wilkes Booth.
Is it A, video, B, John Wilkes Booth, C, the MC10, or Brock Harrison?
All the above. All of the above.
I think video killed the radio star, not the deluxe Coco.
What if it turns out it's Steve Bjork?
Well, in this case, it has been, at least one theory has been established that it was the MC10.
There we go.
C.
This is the current lore. Not necessarily
current, current lore, anyway. Question 16. Who is known as the Apple guy? Is it A, Steve Jobs, B, Mark Overhoser, C, Nick Morentes, or D, the Green Grocer?
That would have to be Mark Overhoser.
Nick Morentes.
Nick Morentes for the win.
He's a trash
can. For the win. Oh, Stevie. That's so bad. Oh, I'm sorry. You're not going to get that your supply of turtle wax.
To be or not to be? That is the question.
But Nick Morentes is known to hang out with Apple guys.
Oh, yes.
We have video evidence.
Oh, yes, we do. Question 17. Whose rage quit ended an entire episode abruptly? Was it A, Mark Bosley, B, Grant Leedy, C, Steve Strobridge, or D, Captain Meltdown?
I think Steve has a new nickname.
Yeah, same? I think so too.
C and D are one and the
definitely
same.
Definitely D.
Mark Bosley's outspoken.
When he's not in his secret identity as the calm, rational Steve Strobridge.
Yeah.
Yes, of course. Of course, we know it's C. I was here. We were here. Let's see here. Let's move on. Question 18. Ed Snyder has been referred to as a competent musician, B, a Cylon, C, a ballerina, D, an essential service.
I would say that
he's
B
not
going
to come on the show now for sure.
Yeah, B and D are both true.
B is a Cylon. It's a compliment. Because he just cranks so much stuff out. It's like, you know, is this guy actually human?
Right. He such put a great start
coming from Ed Snyder.
Yeah, he put a Cylon on the break key on the keyboard, too.
I was just going to say that.
So he acknowledges
not the same
it.
Without the red key.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 19. Who is playing Daggerith like that idiot in the book?
You'll go far, Fletcher.
Is it A, Fletcher, B, Tim Linder, C, Brock Harrison, or D, Grant Leedy?
Brock Harrison for the block.
Is Tim's Brock Harrison is incorrectly?
Yeah,
we saw it spelled correctly.
Tim Lindner. N-E-R.
Yeah.
A little less condescension there, please, Stevie.
Yeah. Well, Coco doesn't have spell check.
We know it's Tim. We saw the bumper.
We know it's Tim. We can fix that in post.
We can just call him that idiot from the book.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
Well, let's move on sorry, to question 20. Why did Tandy do that?
It
would be neat.
Because meatloaf.
B, because meatloaf wouldn't.
Wanted to sell more batteries.
Because it was cheap. Or D, they wanted to sell more batteries.
D, definitely. You know,
I'm reading this out loud for anybody that's, of course, listening to the audio version.
That's
guys,
right.
So just,
that. Just we all know the answer. Spoiler alert.
We know the answer, of course.
Did,
you know.
Why did Tandy do anything? Because they were cheap.
Cheap.
Yes.
Cheap.
C for cheap.
C for cheap, exactly. I didn't even think about that. Was just a happy accident. Who is credited with the EMP incident? Is it A, Grant Leedy, B, Brock Harrison, or is it C, Ethan Michael Peterson, or D, Bill Noble?
I don't know this one.
I thought it was
EMP.
EMP was the fart heard round the world. It went off live in one of our shows. And that's actually on the David Ladd commercial. When you see that explosion, you actually hear that fart that goes off. And we were trying to track it down. But yeah, it was Bill Noble. That was the fart heard round the world, also known as the EMP.
Wow.
Yeah.
I learned it's not Ethan Michael Peterson, though.
It was
a powerful one. That's all I got
to
say.
The next question, to what food was the MP?
That's the only question about
that. Was 100 kilometers away. So.
Yeah,
don't worry, we're almost done. We got two more to go. Question 22. Who will go far? Is it Simon Jonassen,
Yep.
B. Fletcher. No, no. C. Richard Lurbieski. Or D. Johnny Marathon.
E. Wells Fargo.
You'll go far, Fletcher.
I mean, Simon Jonnasen did travel quite a way to go to Coco Fest last
That's
year,
true.
And
he did.
Richard Lurbieski drives right all the way from Texas. So
I will mention in chat right now. TJBChris says I've got a detector for that fart.
That's right. We saw that video.
Yes. Where was I? Don't need that report tomorrow. I need
of course
it
we know it. Of course we
You'll
know it's
far,
Fletcher.
We'll
yeah, we know it's Fletcher. Let's. Okay, this should be the last. I think this is the last question. Who may invite a show guest to lunch? Is it A. Richard Lurbieski, B. David Ladd, C. Ron Delvo, or D. Grant Leedy?
Ron Delvo for the win.
Yeah, and for the win. Let's
it's
see
lunch
here.
Okay. The fishes, oh, is it?
All right. Correct. I think that's it. Okay. Press any key to continue.
And the results are
right. And Stevie, I'm both back and ready to take over.
Score 21. So we got 21 out of 23.
Score 21. 21 out of 23. Yep. Congratulations. You broke through the barrier. Score 21. Enjoy CoCoTALK. Play again.
I am honored
you
to
really
be mentioned
need to play
at all.
Again.
I don't think we need to. No, I think we've all lived through these painful memories. So
yes, we have. And I will. Yeah, that was
Are we going to have another one next week? That would be great.
Oh my goodness. This has been
really
in the work for like 3 weeks.
Oh geez.
We do have
a lot of it was just getting the engine done, but now it's just a matter of putting data statements in, and I have a spelling error I have to correct. And
okay,
that's
so
pretty good if there was only one spelling error, but
No, there was more than one spelling error. You put an ER in my name instead of OR.
Yeah, well,
maybe you're wrong, David. Did you think of that?
Yeah, David. Maybe
I was trying to spell it upside down.
Everyone does that.
You know, this game would be much more exciting if you hooked up 12,000 volts to it.
Right.
Through the cassette relay.
Yeah.
It'll make it click.
I like James Jones' comment in the chat, too. He says he's trying to imagine the Captain Meltdown's costume.
That's funny, Jason.
It's a big M, but it's kind of shrunken.
Captain Meltdown has a, you know, maybe it's like cheese for a cape since it melts. I don't know.
Okay. D. Bruce Moore says you need to upload this to the archive, too.
I think he's missing some day.
Yeah. Okay.
It'll be available. It'll go there. It'll be on my blog at cocoman.org here.
How do you spell
shortly
that?
After.
That
cocoman.org.
O-R-G.
Yes.
That would be a great compliment to any of the products you deliver to people.
And other than that, that's it. I don't know if there's any demand for any more questions, but I thanked everybody for their suggestions.
That was a great segment. Really loved it.
Anything coming next is
okay.
Be
let me try to do something real quick. We're going to try to do this live.
Ron, you're next.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
CoCoTALK will return after these messages. Coco, c'est le coq champignon, des micros et dans le plomb. Pour le jeu, y'a pas papa, les études, c'est pas visa. L'expansion, il en va pas, les commandes, tu vas voir ça. Notre coco est programmable, pour tes cours, c'est bien serviable. Coco de Radio Chaton, on a fait raison de ça.
Un ordinateur couleur qui a de la personnalité. Le Coco 2 de Radio Shack. On solde pour Noël à partir de 149,84.
Coco 2 de Radio Shack, ton affaire est dans le sac, c'est toi.
And now, Coco Thoughts by Samuel Gimes. If you're using your color computer in Quebec and it stops working, is it now a Coco won't do?
Hi, Ron Delvo, Timberman, Coco Fest, Coco Talk.
In a world where RGB produces black and white video, one cable can make a difference. Switcheroo. Coco3SCARTCable.com.
Hey, have you got your Coco 3 yet? Hi, this is Rick Adams, author of Temple of Rom and Shanghai, and you've tuned into Coco Talk, the nation's leading live talk show featuring the Tandy Color Computer.
Get ready.
What's going on, everybody? Original Gamer Stevie Stroh here, and if you're a fan of vintage computing and retro gaming, then you're going to love our retro swag shop at 8bit256.com. There you will find custom designs by Instagram artist Joel M. Adams. You can get I'm a Coconut, Coco Talk, and other cool video game images on a t-shirt, coffee mug, or mouse pack. So if you love retro, then head on over to the retro swag shop at 8bit256.com today. Tell them the Original Gamer Stevie Stroh sent you.
Radio Shack's store-wide manager's red tag sale is on now. We've slashed prices 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%. Save on famous Radio Shack hi-fi, car stereo, radios, toys, TV games, calculators, walkie-talkies, and CB radios. Look for the big red tag. Save like never before on these and literally hundreds of red tag specials. Hurry into Radio Shack today.
Hi, this is Randy Kindig of the Floppy Days Podcast. I just love me some Coco, and nobody covers it better than Steve Strobridge. You're listening to Coco Talk.
Hey, everybody. We're just going to step into the Rondo Garage. Take it away, Ron.
Love Thank you, music. John, my son, for making that song. Awesome. Okay, I'm going to share. It says you cannot share while other participants are. Okay, here we go again. And then I pick this one, and then I pick share. And there. I'm up. No?
You are.
Yeah, you are.
All right. This is the Tomcat 6809 Power. Made this little graphic. This is taken from the Color Computer magazine Rainbow. Anyway, I made this because we were all talking about it at some time or another. And then I thought Alan Huffman, if he had one, he'd be good at moderating. So I put him up on there. And I think I put Frank on here too. Or is he Frank on the Hudson. One? Huh?
Frank is on the TC9 one because Tomcat was his machine.
Yes, there you go. Put some ads on there. And people have contributed things to it and have talked. Go look at it. This was a serious effort to... how many machines were
produced? I think Frank said only 25 TC9s were actually made.
Wow. So. And you know, you see this ad and you think there's got to be thousands of them out there.
Well, there's different parts of the Tomcat, too. I mean, there's the Tiger, there's the TC-70 and the TC-9. I don't know if his 25 was just the TC-9 or if that included the TC-70 sales because those are two separate boards.
Oh, cool. Cool to know.
Neat. So for the sake of those who don't know, what exactly is the TC-9?
The Tomcat was a system, and it was basically meant to be on the K-bus, which is a bus system that he created. And then you could link multiple computers on it. You could put a TC9, which is basically a Coco on a single card with 1 meg of RAM built in, and real 8-bit DAC, real 8-bit ADC, two high-speed serial ports, 384, and a few other niceties like ET keyboard interface. And then the TC70, which is kind of a mini MM1, not quite as sophisticated as the MM1, but pretty close. It basically had the same chip, the same graphics chip, etc. And then he also had other cards he was selling at the time. So you could upgrade it with a 68020 and a 68030. He had, serial port cards, parallel port cards, timer IRQ cards, all kinds of stuff. And the goal was to get them all talking together on the same bus. So the Coco could request the TC70 to do something. The TC70 could request the Coco to do something, or the TC9 to do something. So they could become co-processors for each other. So if you wanted to write a graphics program, you could have the Coco tell the TC70, okay, I want you to do the graphics part and I'll just run the main program. Now that never got fully realized because it was a lot of complicated coding, but the hardware support to do all of that was built in. Unfortunately, as most of the Coco 4 people discovered, actually manufacturing a computer in the age of the PC and the Mac, because this was in the early 90s, just wasn't feasible, unfortunately.
Yeah, I took a copy of this from an ad and stuck it in there on my CorelDRAW. And then the next thing I wanted to share was my hugely fast computer here. Well, that's the same one, darn it. I have to go down to the link. The MM1, which I had one. I got the computer from a guy who bought it originally, and I sold it in the early 2000s for around $700 back then. And I had some software left, and I sent it to David Ladd. But I didn't really have any interest in it anymore because I didn't figure there would be anything. But here it is. Everybody would like to wish they had one.
Yeah,
is this the same graphic as it's almost the same graphic as you showed for the map, Steve? No? Okay.
Yeah, and there's a few people that still have their MM1s, and it definitely was a more popular machine sales-wise than I think the TC70 or the System 4, which is the other Coco 4 as they were advertising them back in Rainbow 1991. Now, Alan Huffman, you've got yours. Have you got it up and running again yet? Or
I'm assuming Alan's still in the call.
I said, do you still have your MM1, and do you have it up and running?
It is not up and running. It is 10 feet away from me, and it will be up and running. I just have not had a time to get to that. Then I have to figure out what I'm going to do for a monitor.
We had a small poll on here. Never had one. Yes, original owner. Yes, bought one from an original owner. No, bought mine from an original owner, then sold it. No, it was an original owner, but got rid of mine. And you can see some have posted on there. It's cool.
Yeah, and you've got Paul Ward, who was the main salesman for the M1. I think it was Kevin Peace designed it. Is that right, Alan?
Yeah.
I don't know if you found him yet, but he'd be a good guy to get a hold of.
Yeah, there's brochures on here. Something about an accelerator, the case that it was in.
And yeah, Alan, you probably know more about the accelerator. I know that there was like a 9 meg RAM expansion board, but there's also a 68,340 base board that sped it up quite a bit, wasn't there?
I never had anything but the 3 meg RAM expansion, but there was some kind of accelerator. I know James Jones had it.
And Alan, is that your hand?
Yes, it is. That's a screenshot from that video somebody pointed out from the DigiGrade magazine, the compiler magazine.
And this is what we're going to see in a minute.
A white screen.
Tick tock.
Are you running in dial-up, Rob?
It's from the Zipster zone.
Could this be any more white? Uh-oh.
Nice. Look at how pretty that is.
Yeah, with all the M&Ms on the table.
Is that what those are?
Yep. That was on purpose.
And that's what my MM1 looks like, is what's in that magazine.
Is it?
That's making me hungry.
What are we looking at here?
Well, you're looking at the two boards and the backplane. One of them is the CPU board with the base RAM. The other one's what they called the I/O board, which had the extra serial ports. And then later they had an upgraded backplane that you could upgrade your MM1 to a total of 9 meg. The 1 meg of video RAM and plus 2 4 meg SIMs that you could have.
I will mention the TC9 was also a two board set too. There was an IO board and then the main CPU gimme board too.
So this board here is the one down below. This one.
Well, whichever one has the 68340 or 68070 on, it's the CPU board.
Is that a real-time clock right there?
Yes, that's yes. Dallas 1287.
Awesome.
Sadly.
Why sadly?
Because you have to saw it apart with a Dremel tool to put a new battery in it.
Oh, pain in the butt, huh? All right, that's about it for me, except for when this last one thing. This is a snowstorm with a polar bear. Can you see the polar bear?
Not yet.
Not yet? Well, just wait, and it'll pop right up.
I see a polar bear. It's white.
There you do?
Yeah, it's white.
He's winking at you. That's why you can't see his eyes.
Now, Ron, are you planning on putting up a System 4 page as well for the other
one? I don't know. I might. I don't know anything about it. I did this mainly to inspire.
Hey, Ron.
I only had, yeah.
I had to step away for a minute. I was on the phone with Mark Zuckerberg. He had asked if you could kindly reduce the Facebook groups because their servers can't handle the content anymore. you've overloaded Facebook.
Oh, it's pretty to have anyway. Look, this is my...
It's quite a feat.
This is my thing for you to show your color computer. And I put mine on there just recently because I got the... what is that gizmo? What do they call that thing that hooks up to
the SCART HDMI converter?
Yes. Oh, wait,
okay. Sorry.
Exactly.
What?
Switcheroo. Right. And then I put old pictures up from everybody. Oh, look at somebody's wall. Yep. So there's a bunch of stuff in here. The best way to view it sometimes is just hit photos when you go to any of the groups, because then you've got a whole slew of all the stuff that's been on display in it. And it's really cool. You see something you like, click on it, and you can learn a little bit more about it.
Hey, Mark D. Overholzer, can you post a link to Ron's Garage in the chat? Is Mark here?
He's there. He's probably
muted, is he?
Muted.
Okay.
Muted. But anyways, lots of goodies in there.
It's a few of my photos hidden in that lot.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
All kinds of stuff.
I've posted in there before also.
Yeah, when somebody
about
posts
doing it today.
When somebody posts something about a going online or whatever, we get a flurry of stuff. You can see cool. Like a whole group of Telnet things. So anyway, that's about it for me. The idea is I love to have these pages up to inspire people to talk or do things, show things. And what's cool is every day I think what happens is every day when you bring your computer up and you go on Facebook, you start looking at, let's see what's Ron's been doing, because he's on all the time, always posting stuff. And then there's all these places you can go to now, the Coco group, the OS9 group, the Ron's Garage. Then there's Show the Computer. There's Coco Pie. There's all kinds of stuff. So.
Pie.
Yeah.
I did see the Coco Couleur, C-O-L-E-U-R, up there in a box somewhere. Okay, no, just another one.
French one.
Okay, so how do I get back out of here now?
Okay. Can I go next?
Sure.
Yes, go ahead, Mikey.
Oh, hope you guys like my extremely poor graphical skills.
Nice.
Is that a Corvette?
I drive where? I don't know. It was just an SVG car. So, anyway, I've been doing a little bit of work on PyDriveWire. Haven't completely decided when the next release is going to be, but I may push a minor release out in the next week. I'm thinking about doing that along with some other CoCoTALK activities that are going on, or to coincide with those activities. And the main thing that I've added is I've added the ability to work with Dragon VDK images, which PyDriveWire didn't know how to do previously. And that seems to work okay. And I'm currently working on adding SSH, which has been a request for a long time. And I have the initial implementation of that going, and my testers are testing away. So when that starts working, then, you know, if you look back on the Coco mailing list, people are whining about telnetting. Oh, thou shalt not telnet ever. So,
Can I just say to the mailing list, can you STFU by any chance?
Oh, it was a feature request. I wanted to do it, and
now that
I have binary releases going, I can actually add that stuff into it, and you guys don't have to deal with all the installation garbage that the source code users have to use. So, I think this will be coming in the next week, I think, as I said, to correspond with some upcoming future CoCoTALK activities. So that's my update. I'm going to go eat, go get a sandwich. I'm starving.
I have an update too whenever you guys go around the room.
Okay. Go ahead.
Ah, okay. Well, this came in the mail just the other day, but this is the AV cable for my Dragon. So this plugs into the mini DIN connector on the back. And I ordered this from the UK. Thank you, Al Hartman, for giving me the link, right? So it's got the mini DIN connector on one side, and then it's got your composite out and your, looks like stereo out for no less, right? So yeah, cool stuff. Right. So that came in from, it's called novelties.co.uk. And I got it on eBay, thanks to the link from Al Hartman from Jersey.
You couldn't get that from Coco Man?
You know, I'm sure Jason could probably make, you know what, Jason, if I could get one with a color, I mean, with a switch, if I can get a Dragon output with a switch, that would be great. Yeah.
Well, first I have to get a Dragon. I'm only one step away.
Okay. So that's all for me.
Steve, are you going to get a drive for that Dragon?
A what now?
A drive for the Dragon?
I plan on using drive wire with the Dragon. So.
Is it drive wire or dragon wire?
Dragon.
Dragon wire. Dragon wine.
Yeah. Your wire's Dragon.
Okay. I have an update. Neo's going to join in and try and tell you all about it as well. That's timing, pussycat. What are you up to? Sorry about that. I did find out why Neo is so meowy, actually, and why he's meowing so loud. He's actually got a hearing problem. He's 16 years old, and he's an old pussycat. And he,
what did you say?
Realize how...
That's what he said. Poor thing.
He's an old one.
Yeah, he's 16 years old. That's not my update anyway, but Neo's come to join me. So my update is I have a new Pulse Eternal album that I've just released a couple of days ago. The Pulse Eternal album doesn't have the Coco on the actual music, but it does have it on the front cover of the album. I don't know if I can do that from here. Let's see if I can share photo. Let's see if this will work. Gallery. Go to there. Let me go down to my Pulse Eternal folder. Here we go. And I do that. Can you guys see that? Oh, wait a minute. Start video. Can you guys see that now?
20. Yeah, I see the OK prompt, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the way I come up with this album cover, it's very sort of retro 80s sort of music on it, with a bit of a modern touch. So I wanted the album cover to reflect the retroness of it. And what better way to reflect, you know, 80s retro than our beloved Coco's? So what you're seeing in the Ray-Ban sunglasses there, the 2020 is actually a Coco font. What I did was I used Coco VGA on my original Coco One, switched it on, typed 2020 into the Coco, and got my phone and took a photo of the screen and then dragged it into Photoshop and did the same thing with the OK prompt.
Now, so, are all those lights around it from a disco ball?
Could be.
Yeah, no, that's what it looks like.
Yeah, no, the rest of it was done in Photoshop. So I dragged a photo from my phone. It's literally a photo of an LCD screen with Coco VGA displaying the Coco font.
Yeah, it looks good.
So yeah, that album is available on the Pulse Eternal website. I've got to update the website and put the link on there, but you can click on Bandcamp and go onto there and get to the album. So yeah, that's pretty much my update.
Is this the Coco Music album that's all done on the Coco? No.
No. It's a precursor to that. Okay. I'm still working on the Coco Music album, but So this one, just the cover is from it. So yeah.
Very nice. My update.
Anyone else? We can take a short break and look at the new Coco thoughts.
Did you run your new commercial that I didn't see?
Rob? I will do that. I didn't want to make people wait for Coco thoughts, but yeah.
Okay, I didn't know if I missed it when I was on the phone with Mark Zuckerberg.
No. Okay. All
right. Your audio is a little bit crackly right now. Just so you know.
I believe you, maybe Brian Shubring has done your engineering for you at this point. So okay. I'm messing with you.
I fixed that now.
I know you did. I know you did.
All right.
Yeah. I'm actually looking forward to seeing the new Coco Thoughts.
Okay. Let's try it. Let's see if it works. Here we go.
And now, Coco Thoughts by Samuel Gimes. I didn't see these boulders bounce once. Try maiming, mangling boulders where the diamonds kill you too.
That was good.
Truth in advertising.
Samuel Gimes is a deep thinker.
He sounded a little bitter. I hope Samuel's okay. Samuel.
Doesn't he always sound a little bitter?
Yeah. I think Samuel's taken us all away. He's destroyed the panel.
We've lost the panel, Rob. Just hit clear.
Yeah, well,
you know. There we go. We're back.
Yeah, we go.
Deck B, where clear actually clears the screen.
All right.
That's good.
All right. So why don't we watch my little announcement for an upcoming birthday, and then we'll take a commercial break. We'll come back. I'll do a really short demo in ease of use. And we'll close with final thoughts. So here's the birthday announcement.
This message.
Hi, this is Chris Boyle, part of the CoCoTALK crew of people.
Hey everybody, this is Bill Noble, co-author of NitrOS9. You are listening to CoCoTALK Live, the leading live CoCoTALK show.
G'day mates, this is Nick Marionettes, author of such color computer titles as Donut Disaster, Rupert Rhymes, and Rockstar Pilot. And I am here today to tell you about the world's most fabulous operating system, OS9. OS9 and its current incarnation, NitrOS9, is the most advanced operating system ever created. And what makes it so good? Ease of use. I find OS9 so incredibly intuitive that I haven't once cracked open the user manual. And yet I've been able to create such incredible games faster than the time it takes to sing Waltzing Matilda. Using OS9, I expect my next game, Funstar, will be done this weekend and distributed exclusively on ROM cartridge. OS9 forever.
Any resemblance to actual events, to persons living or dead, is purely coincidental.
We are back, and I'm gonna share my real hardware and show a little tip on ease of use. And Curtis, feel free to chime in here. But really just a simple thing that I wanted to show beginners. So I am going to switch my camera. Hopefully this here. Oh, you can. Okay. Okay, I need to. It's not. You Yes, that's right. Hold on. Okay.
Any audio now too?
Like there's no sound on the chat.
Yeah, we have other people saying what's happening. So they're not, I don't know what's going on, Rob.
Yeah, I fixed it. I continuously fix things for the show. I'm obviously a little flustered. So when things break, you know, they can get fixed. So why don't we
okay, everybody's saying the sound is back, but we're not seeing your demo screen.
I know. So why don't we
did you like my polar bear thing?
Yeah, I like it. It was nice and white.
It was different. Very well than this.
The polar bear was—he was camo. He was in camo.
Yeah.
Great, and welcome back to the show. We can do final thoughts. I did remember what I had to do to be able to see that video, so I can do that quick walkthrough of the build command. I'm going to spotlight this video. And this should be viewable now. Welcome back, everybody, from the closing credits. And I'm going to show you a quick tutorial in ease of use.
Asparagus.
All right.
Now we're in caboose.
And then I'm going to jump off the roof of my building. anyway, how are y'all?
Learning to fly.
You can see my screen here.
Yes.
One of the things that as a beginner, I would have liked to have known, certainly back in the day, is this command, and I'll show it to you, and it creates quick text files. And I'll show you why that's useful. So you can see we're at our desktop here. Now, everywhere you go in G-Shell, it knows where you are. That may seem very simple things, but in OS9, with all the execution directories and data directories and having to figure that out, you don't have to worry about that. So I'm going to click over to H1, which is my user hard drive that I mounted in the SDC as Shift-1 to mount. And you can see that I've got some text files here. I've got something called bug list and something called wish list, and if I want to list those, I can click on those and list those, and you can see it's just text that I've written to share with Curtis.
Hey Rob, is there anything you can do to bring up your volume?
How about that?
It's also kind of crackling like crazy.
Is it? And I'm crackling.
Yes.
Yeah, crackling badly. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well,
not so much. It's still going.
Yeah. All right. Well, that I can't really do anything about. So that's a failure.
Your crackling isn't as bad as just your volume. Your volume's low.
Especially on YouTube, from everybody saying you're coming in one side and
quite I mean, low. I can go louder. Wee. So whatever you want. Okay. Is that better?
Volumes are right here.
Volume-wise.
Okay. Yeah, stream, can you guys let us know what you... They're not hearing the crackle on YouTube, apparently, but...
We'll fix it in post.
There's two audios.
A little better, yeah. Your volume's coming a little better.
Yeah, it sounds clear here.
Yeah.
All right. Anyway, while I slip my wrists in the background...
it's not that bad.
That's another one for the quiz game later on.
Anyway, so you can create these small text files, and obviously this is text. So the reason why this can be useful is that OS9 will attempt to execute any text file as if it is a command. So if you're looking up commands or you want to type in the display codes for the IBM font that Lord Dragon created, or Curtis gives you something in chat, or you see something in the OS9 manual that you want to type in, for example, setting up your Windows or opening a window, you can create a little text file so you don't have to remember that. So I'm going to do that right now. I'm going to hit the S key to bring up the shell.
Now it automatically puts me into my user hard drive. I don't have to tell it where I am because it knows where I am. I'm going to type build, and I'm going to build a VDG, a short file that will open a VDG window for me. And so I'm going to just call this VDG win. And then I'm going to type in some gobbledygook that who cares what it means because I don't have to remember it. So I'm going to type this stuff in. And okay, so I typed the text in. Now I could have just typed any old words. These happen to be commands that OS9 will execute. And I just hit enter. I can then exit this small shell. And now you'll see the file placed on my desktop, which I can now run and create a VDG window. So you see VDG win is here. Now, if I want to see what it is that was, I can list it. It will list the text, what I typed in there. And if I double click now, it will execute the text. And there's my VDG window. So
just hit clear.
So it's just a short example of a command that, you know, you can use every day and see stuff in OS9 and just create a text file. You don't have to remember all those codes, and it makes OS9 a little bit easier to use. So that's my demo.
Cool.
Yep, it's a handy little thing to do. I mean, text files in OS9 are a bit complicated because there's no fixed extension. So like the startup file, which is your startup batch file that, you know, right now I've got loading fonts, it puts a splash screen on and stuff. Is basically a text file. So if you double click in G shell, it defaults to a text file trying to be a batch file, basically is what it's doing, which is why if it's really a text file, like, you know, a documentation file or your next great novel or whatever it is, if you double click, it'll try to run it, of course, and that will cause problems. I think we have to kind of standardize that. Maybe if you're editing a text file that's meant to be text, maybe we got to start using .txt and we'll assign an icon to a text file. But then we have to decide what we want to do with that. Do you want to view the text file, in which case I could run the view program or list or something like that? Do you want to edit it, in which case you might want to run sled or ed or minted or any of these editors or whatever else? So that's where the complication lies, is, you know, what should the default be? And it might be different for different people. Maybe I've got to, you know, set it up two different ways and people pick the one they want. I'm not quite sure how to do that yet, but that's what's going on behind the scenes. And basically anything that's just a plain text file, it just assumes it's a batch file and tries to run it as such.
Cool. I don't know, Curtis. It sounds like you're rushing stuff. I mean, do we know for sure that TXT should be used as an extension for text files? I mean, I think we should.
Let's call it TX2 instead for the text version 2. Yeah, correct.
Exactly. Okay.
Let's have, or you can use doc or something, like, maybe, I don't know.
You mean DOX?
If I could chime in, I think animals are going to be really popular and people are going to have like GNUs and all kinds of things. So since there's a really versatile animal that can like sleep and fly and drink blood and everything called a bat, I think you could use that extension for all the things that aren't text files that you want them to run.
Because they're flexible. Sure.
Well, alternatively, I believe most of you had a caching scheme where if you went through a directory that assigned .txt to, you know, af.txt to view, then after that it was view. But if you had first went to a directory that assigned af.txt to Dynastar, and after that it was Dynastar. And so depending on how you left the root of your hard drive, then as you wandered into data directories, your multiview would do different things.
Yeah, and that's where it gets complicated, because sometimes you might go into directory, I want to edit this file. Another time you want to view it, it's the same file. What do you do? I'm seriously considering at this point is actually making alternate ones and then actually doing a right click, and then it'll pop up a menu saying, which of these programs would you like to run? That's a bit further in the future, because that's going to take a fair bit of recoding, but that's the eventual plan.
I was just going to suggest that. That seemed like a logical thing to do.
Now, a question for the panel here for that.
I have a question. Can somebody check Ron Delvo for a pulse? I think we have.
I'm gone. I'm gone.
Now, a quick question for the panel here. For those of you that have been fiddling with the ease of use edition here, how many of you actually have two button joysticks or two button mice to have a right mouse button to click?
Yes.
Yeah, I do. I've got two deluxe joysticks.
Do we have any people that only have single button ones? Because that would cause a problem.
Can't do a modifier key?
Could you do like Apple? Yeah.
I could try, I guess. Yeah, maybe an alt click or something, or control click or something.
Yeah.
I do want to not leave people out that, you know, just bought a Coco on eBay and don't have the fancy two-button hardware.
Maybe you could do it.
It would be both. I'm just trying to figure out a way to make it clean and easy. I mean, right now the alternative is you could run the keyboard mouse because it has two buttons regardless, F1 and F2. So
why don't you have an ad for John Strong right there?
Yeah.
For a two-button mouse.
I've got some people in the chat say they only have single-button mice, so that's definitely a concern. I'll have to think about that and exactly how many.
What about the button on the other joystick?
And the other thing I could do is actually figure out how to get multi-view to properly, you know, handle the fact that you can have multiple programs assigned to the same extension, and how am I going to, you know, handle that? Because right now that's not built in whatsoever. So it's on the long list of things to do.
Do you keep that list on OS 9?
Some of it is, yeah.
That's why it's long. Extension of the file.
Okay. Where's our crickets?
Let's roll the credits again.
All right. Well, we already rolled the credits. This was kind of our caboose. So thanks for everybody for chiming in and let me do the demo. Yes, audio to YouTube is usually fine. Sometimes we have some problems in the Zoom audio. And anyway, thanks. Sorry about the technical problems. Appreciate everybody's patience. And hope you liked the new look and feel of background today. And
it was awesome.
Appreciate Jason Reichert and Stevie kind of rescuing us there for that segment. And, you know, thanks for hanging in there. Definitely appreciate everybody who works hard to come up with content
So we're not going to do a caboose?
The caboose was going to be just a gameplay of like Downland. I mean, we could, but I figured, you know, might as well
maybe tonight.
Yeah, we could do it through
Discord too. We can do like the video. Have we ever had an actual After Dark?
We used to. We have not had an
official After Dark in quite some time, but we have been doing some evening things, but we haven't called it After Dark.
I come back and you guys are pulling the plug already.
Yeah.
We haven't done our final thoughts yet.
Well, we're 3 hours.
Yeah, we've had a pretty good show overall, good other than the difficulties. So,
well, listen, I just want to say something real quick since we're not going to do the caboose here. Number one, Rob Inman, I would like to applaud your tenacity and to pull off the show of everything you did. You basically reskinned the show and you gave it a theme. You made it your own, and other than some unfortunate, you know, technical problems that are beyond our control, I really appreciate you stepping up to do this and giving it all the flair that you did. So thank you, Rob Inman, for doing that.
Sure, and I think somebody mentioned VLC, and obviously that is now going
and,
to be.
And my only suggestion would be is if you can get a lot less Nitrous 9 crap in the show, it would be a lot more watchable for most people.
Yeah, more high drive layer.
And the other thing, of course, is to quit hosting it on Windows, which crashes all the damn time.
Amen.
When you run it in an emulator, it becomes Ease of Crash.
But we pulled it. We pulled it together. We got her done.
Yep. Get her done. No,
All right. Well, all right. I think we can hit the button. And thanks everyone for joining today.
Bye. This concludes another episode of Coco Talk, the world's leading live talk show featuring the Tandy Color Computer. For all things Coco Talk, visit us on the web at CocoTalk.live. We'd love to hear from you. Send feedback, suggestions, even segments via email to CocoTalk@CocoTalk.live.
Coco Talk is rocking the 8-bit world, keeping the Tandy flame alive. We may be mocked, but we'll never stop, because Coco Talk is rocking the 8-bit world.
Consider supporting the show with a purchase of merchandise from our retro swag shop at 8bit256.com. If you'd like to become a patron of the show, click the Patreon link at our website at CocoTalk.live.
CocoTalk is rocking the 8-bit world, keeping the tiny flame alive. We may be mocked, but we'll never stop, because CocoTalk is rocking the 8-bit world.
CocoTalk would not exist without the community, its cast, crew, and contributors. Thanks go to Curtis Boyle, David Ladd, Mark Overholzer, Grant Leedy, Bruce Moore, Nick Marentes, Ron Delvaux, Rick Adams, Jason Riker, Richard Lorbieski, Jim Brain, Tom C., Rob Inman, Mark Bosley, Brian Joyce, Ken Riker, David O'Connor, Brian Weisler, Terry Steggy, Nick Marotta, John Strong, and many more, especially to Steve Bjork for production suggestions and James Diffendaffer for making my head explode. Please help support the Coco community by visiting some of its various contributors. A list of resources is available at imacoconut.com. That's imacoconut.com. The Coco Talk theme song is copyright 2008 by D. Bruce Moore and Greg Sheeler. Mixed, mastered, and produced by D. Bruce Moore.